Alrighty. Well, hey, if I don't jump on, then have a good show there.
Appreciate it.
Well, it's nice to say hello, Mike. Have you ever given, man?
Yeah, it was good to say hello, and I'm hoping I can get out of here soon.
Well, good luck.
Aren't you the boss? Don't you make the rules?
The rules are the work needs to be done.
Oh, yeah, I don't like that rule. Yeah.
But yeah.
It affects us all.
I mean, yeah, sure. I could have gone home right at 5 o'clock and then had 2 full days worth of work waiting for me when I came in tomorrow.
Those are prizes.
Yeah, that's the way to do it.
Consolation prize.
Yeah. Alrighty. Well, maybe I'll talk to you, or maybe I won't. But either way, enjoy.
All right. Thanks, Mark.
See ya.
Hey.
That was the most different way that I think we've ever started a show. Okay, this is Game Boost Podcast, episode 287. I'm Aaron, the only host here right now. Mike and Tiny. Mike is stuck at work. Tiny hopefully will be joining us soon. So I guess that's it. So it's just me. No, I'm kidding. We have a guest who has graciously donated some of his time to come back and hang out with us. We have Jules, formerly of Renegade Kid. Now it's Atui, correct?
That's right, man. Yeah. Hey, how you doing, man? Good to see you. Well, talk to you again.
Yeah, I'm glad to
hang
back
out with you. Yeah, man, definitely. Yeah, that's right. Renegade Kid is no more, sadly.
That is sad. A lot of people, I don't know if you realized. Were you overwhelmed by the people who reached out? Like, wait, what?
It was a sad week. I mean, I knew that going into it, you know, and even I knew that. You know, I knew way before, of course, we announced it because we had to talk about it and really decide it. But when it came time to actually reveal it, you know, that it was a sad week, you know, because Greg and I had, you know, we've been doing that for basically 10 years. Actually, we'd known each other and worked together for many years prior to that. So we've known each other for a long, long time. So, yeah, it was the end of an era, which is sad, you know, because we were very proud of what we accomplished as a Renegade Kid. But, you know, it was just for various reasons. It was just time for us to change, you know. Me and Greg are still good friends and stuff, but just business-wise, we just wanted to kind of... Well, it wasn't quite working out financially, unfortunately. It's always a struggle, you know, doing something creative and trying to make money out of it. So we just thought we'd make some changes. And yeah, it was sad, man. But anyway, but you know, we're both excited as well for our new stuff. You know, I'm doing Atui, Greg's doing Infinitismo. And we split up the IPs, so he gets all the 3D games such as Moon and Dementium, and I get all the 2D stuff like Mutant Muds and Zero Drifter and so on. So yeah, so it worked out well in the end.
Yeah, you all, like, I went to the website and you all broke it down, like, it's very clear, like, this is going, yes, to Infinitismo, this is going to, yes, Atui.
Yeah, made it nice and clear.
I don't want to get too into the weeds, but was it fairly easy to come up with who was going to take what IP with them?
Thankfully it was. I mean, this is, I guess, technically it's very similar to a divorce, you know, logistically, right? You're kind of like, you know, mom and dad are breaking up and you have to figure out where the kids are going, is one way of looking at it. Unfortunately, you know, we didn't even have to discuss it or debate it. You know, it was just like, I don't even know who said it first or how we even come up with it, but it was just an assumption on both of our parts that, yeah, you know, you take the 3D stuff, I'll take the 2D stuff, and yeah, and we're both like, yeah, that's great. You know, that makes it nice and simple. Yes, you know, you could get down to the nitty gritty and kind of go, okay, well, how much money did this game make and how much did that make? And let's make it exactly even as much as possible and blah, blah, blah. You could really get into the gross side of things if you really wanted to, but we're like, that's beside the point, you know. We like each other, we want to move on. You know, let's get the IPs that we love. We love all of them, of course, but the ones that we want to kind of continue doing stuff with. Not to say that I wouldn't love to continue doing Dementium, but you know, there has to be a compromise, there has to be a give and take. And I'm, you know, I'm very happy with the 2D stuff. So, and that really just fit nicely with my vision for Atui, which is very much focused on the retro inspired games. You know, our little slogan is Retro Roots Modern Mojo.
I like that.
As far as, thanks, man. You know, just kind of being inspired by the retro stuff, but, you know, with modern sensibilities. They're not just trying to be an 8-bit or a 16-bit or whatever game. That's not the point. It's not about being the exact technical parameters of the NES or whatever.
I don't think anybody really wants that. People might say they want that, but not.
Yeah. And that's great if that's what you want to do, but that's, I'm not interested in that. I don't care whether it's accurate or not. It just needs to be a fun experience that, that respects what it's doing and where it's coming from, where it's going, and, you know, and there you go. So it worked out well, man. So it's exciting, and like I say, we're still good friends, and we'll help each other out. You know, I'm happy to tweet out and, you know, pimp out all of Greg's stuff and vice versa. So so it should be fun. Okay. First game is Chicken Wiggle, we are working on, which is super fun. So that'll be a 3DS game, where it's a puzzle platformer, but you can also, it has a built-in editor, so you can make your own levels and share them online with people. So so it's super fun, actually. It's come together really well. We showed off the game to some people at PAX West in Seattle in September, so that was good. That was great to have people play it and kind of get their feedback and go, cool, people actually are able to play it for a start, because we kind of make it in a vacuum, you know. So it's kind of nice to see people like out in the wild play it and go, cool, they actually get it, awesome. Not, you know, because we don't know, we know everything because we made it. So it's nice to get someone with fresh eyes without us explaining it. It's like, just give them the game and see what happens, and can they get to the end of the level, and if that's the case, then awesome, the game is saying what it needs to say for them to have fun. So that worked out well. So yeah, man. So fun stuff. So yeah, that's what mainly what I'm focusing on right now is Chicken Wiggle, and then after that is moving on to finishing up Treasure Knots, which is very exciting. But we can talk about more that later if you like. But so that's an exciting aspect as well of Atui that we will be continuing and finishing up and releasing Treasure Knots for sure.
Treasure Knots is to me where the giant enemy crabs belong. That's
right, exactly, the big mama crab. Because I think probably when we, I don't know if it was when we first met, but it was years ago, when I probably had the Treasure Knots demo with me, yeah? On 3DS, yeah. Maybe? I don't know.
That's right.
Did I have it at the time? Yeah. And that was many, many years ago. So it's been a while. So it's nice to be able to come back to that and finish it up. So yeah, super excited about that. So as soon as Chicken Wiggle's done, yeah, moving on to Treasure Knots is going to be awesome. And we have plans to get that wrapped up in a decent amount of time. So people, you know, it would be crazy years ahead. You know, we're planning on releasing it next year, so it's very exciting.
Okay, I noticed you said we several times, so who is Atui made up of outside of you?
Okay, yeah, so I work, it's me and Matthew essentially is the core team. It's just the two of us. Matthew Gambrell, so Matthew's a programmer and I'm a designer and artist. And so Matthew was the programmer on all of our 2D stuff. So Neomuds, Bomb Monkey, Zero Drifter, Treasure Knots, as well as helping out on some of the 3D games as well. So he was the programmer on all of those. And we're continuing, our work now as Atui. So that's the we. It's he and I. Troop, we'll continue working with Troop. He did the music for Muds. You know, he did the music for Treasure Knots, and we'll continue to work with him on Treasure Knots as well. So, and that's it. We're very small, very lean. That's the kind of the idea for Atui, is to stay as lean as possible, but spend a little bit more time on the games. It can be a bit more full, so it can be a bit more kind of cost effective, hopefully, and more profitable in the long run. In theory, we'll see. That's the hope, anyway.
And you all are still, you're still mainly focused on getting them to Nintendo platforms initially.
Actually, obviously for Chicken Wiggle, it's already set in stone. You know, that's, you know, definitely going to be on the 3DS. It's, you know, what happens to the 3DS once the NX comes out. You know, I mean, I know Nintendo is saying that it will continue into like 2018 or whatever.
They said about the GBA back in 2004.
Indeed. They always say, oh, it's just an extra pillar.
Exactly.
Like, yeah, but that's of course what you would say, right? You would want to say, yeah, it's going to die as soon as this new one comes out. They have to forget about careful. It. They couldn't say that.
And then they Samson knock it over.
Yeah, exactly. So, so who knows how long the 3DS is going to last. And honestly, I know nothing about the NX. I can't plan for that because I don't know anything about it.
You know, Drew,
it's coming out in March.
My ulterior motive for inviting you on the show was two reasons. One, I enjoyed the last show we did. I enjoyed seeing you at PAX. And I wanted to pick your brain and get you to give me the hot scoops. And I guess what you're saying is that you don't have any hot scoops.
Yes, sorry. You're going to be very disappointed. I have no hot scoops.
I'm kidding. I know that the fact that no one has found out, I mean, of course, some of the patent stuff, who knows how much of that has been true. I'm surprised any of that stuff got, I shouldn't be surprised it got out, but normally it's that and then the deluge of more information. But that hasn't happened. Yeah. It's almost like they lock people up when they're working on this stuff.
Yeah. I mean, it seems like a lot of people say that the Eurogamer article was very accurate, which was actually almost word for word what Emily Rogers had already tweeted out or written in her blog or two before that. A lot of people are saying that stuff's accurate. I have absolutely no idea, but it seems reasonable. You know, it sounds cool. You know, I mean, it all comes down to execution, you know, which obviously Nintendo can be masters at, but they can also mess it up, as we saw with the Wii U, so, you know, or the Virtual Boy, or depending on what you want to look at, you know. So they've had, you know, home runs, and they've had, wow, that was a bunt. So just to use some baseball terms there for a second, for some random reason.
And, you know, when you look back on, like, the GameCube, like, I like the GameCube, I'm looking at one of the ones, I have two, I'm looking at one of them now. Great system.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it was, it's wonderful.
I don't know how it did for them financially, I just don't have a clue. I know in terms of the sales, some of his competition was nowhere near, but I guess because they're just games that I just like the system. So I guess it didn't really matter to me how it did. Like, there's stuff I like.
True. I mean, and I think a lot of times they, to some degree, have that kind of outlook as well. You know, as long as they're making money, who cares how they compare to Sony and Microsoft? They're like, hey, we're being profitable. We're being smart. We've made something that we can make money on each time we sell it. We have our own proprietary media that we sell the game on, so we're making money every time someone else makes a game. So, you know, as long as they're making money and staying, you know, financially, you know, in a good place, then, yeah, I guess they're happy, you know? And they're getting to be creative and have fun, and they're not worried so much about trying to, you know, the arms race, you know, that basically Sony and Microsoft that are doing as far as being in the most powerful, amazing
arms race.
Yeah, they're not worried about that, you know, which is very wise, and it's kind of liberating, I'm sure, for them. They get to focus on fun, interactive, or whatever they want. You know, they get to just focus on the game, on the experience, which is fun, on the hardware that comes with that. So, and I really deeply respect that. That's amazing. It takes a lot of balls to do that. But they have the money, and it's worked out for them, obviously, on a number of occasions. So, yeah, it's exciting. You know, it's really exciting. So, it's going to be, man, it's going to be fun, man. It's going to be tomorrow morning, right? It's going to be fun to find out what happens about the NX.
Who knows? Who knows? But, you know, full disclosure, I'd be lying if I said that at no point had I ever uttered something close to Nintendo should go third party. There have been times where I've been like, what are they doing? You know, so I just want to make sure I'm not pretending as if I've always been like, yeah, they're making the right move here. I'd be lying if I said that, you know.
Well, they make such good games. I think it's unreasonable, you know, for people to go like, hey, they should just go software. And that's fine, you know, because they do have amazing software. But I've always liked their hardware choices, you know. From the little Game Boy to even the Wii U. They've always done it very, very well. You know, they're always fun to use, and they're done very smart. You know, they like with Sony, for example, they made, like, I think it was the PS3, I can't remember what it was now, but, you know, they've sometimes released a console, and every time they release it for a certain period, they're selling it at a loss just to get it out there and to get into people's hands, because the hardware inside it is so cutting edge and so new. It's just expensive to manufacture. So, you know, they're barely breaking even or maybe even taking a loss. So, but with Nintendo, I don't know if they've ever done that. Certainly not to a large degree, and not on the same scale as the other guys anyway. And they typically quite the opposite, where they use a bunch of old hardware, basically clobber it together in a really smart, intelligent way, and then make great games for it, and then they're making profit, you know, hand over fist. So it's very clever, you know. So they're not only just like, hey, let's make something awesome, they're also being very wise from a business perspective on, hey, let's make it awesome, but let's make it cost effective, let's balance those two things, which is really the heart of the company. You know, they're designers, you know, they design it from a usability perspective, but also from a, you know, a reality just kind of perspective, as far as, well, we're a business, we have to make money here, so let's not be silly, let's not make it out of, you know, make it gold plated or anything crazy like that, let's be careful and do this so we can stay in business. So it's, yeah, it's pretty amazing. So I've always liked their hardware perspective, so I hope they stay in hardware forever, because I've always seen that as just kind of part and parcel with their games, you know, especially when you look at, well, pretty much every system, you know, up to, I guess, and including probably the N64, not so much after that, but I think up to the N64, every system had a Mario game that fully took advantage of the hardware, you know, just showed you everything that it could do, and you're like, oh, that's awesome. And that was always exciting, you know, where you get the machine, you get your Mario game, and they go hand in hand, and you're like, oh, like, you know, Mario 64, of course, or Super Mario World. You mean, they're always like, oh, wow, that totally took advantage of the machine, which was exciting. It was a showcase, you know, as soon as it came out. Yeah, I'm hoping they continue forever with the old hardware stuff. I love it.
I guess I got to bring up the GameCube again, since you mentioned that. It's just, you know, it launched with Luigi's Mansion, and then,
right.
I don't know how you feel about Mario Sunshine, but it was not one of my favorites. Like, I enjoyed it, but it did not capture that, and that Mario 64 magic. Now, Galaxy 2 captured it,
right?
Like, and then some.
Yeah, I agree. I liked Sunshine a lot. But yeah, I agree, though. It wasn't as special as 64 or Galaxy. But I liked it a lot. It was really well designed, very creative. And I played the whole thing. I really, really enjoyed the experience. But yeah, it wasn't as magical as the other ones. I totally agree.
But the stakes were kind of high. It'll be tough to come out and have it be, oh, this is better. Like, you know, that was a pretty big shoes to fill.
Yeah, I think they're just experimenting with bigger, more exploratory, kind of expansive, I guess, kind of levels. And visually, it was a huge step up from Mario 64. I mean, the graphics for the time were really impressive. You know, so they're always balancing that, you know, because again, they're trying to be cost effective in every way they can, as well as being practical and awesome and all the rest of it. So, it was a milestone in some regards, because I remember just the first time when you're in Delfino Plaza and you chase the guy or whatever, the Shadow Mario or whatever his name is, the blue painty weird guy, you know, and he jumps into the hole, and then the M thing, the portal opens up, and all this cool kind of like effects, you know, sun rays almost come through it, and you kind of jump into it and kind of get deconstructed into little floaty balls, and they get sucked in, and you go into the level, and you're like the first time you see that, you're like, oh my gosh, that's so cool, you know. Like, now it's like, yeah, whatever, it's a particle effect, but you know, but then it was like, wow, this is like next gen gaming, you know. And that stuff you could not do on the N64, not as smooth, not as lovely as they did. So and I loved running around Delfino Plaza. The music was amazing.
It was relaxing, wasn't it?
Yeah, and it's very tropical. I'm a huge fan of tropical. Actually, the roots, the source of the name Atui, is actually James Cook's name for the Hawaiian island Kauai, when he quote-unquote discovered it back in whatever year it was. And that's what he named Kauai at the time, just because he was a foreigner and he thought he'd rename everything, because that's what weird, arrogant foreigners do when they come to a land, apparently. But when they were called the Sandwich Islands, Sandwich Isles, the name of Kauai was Atui, and I thought that was a nice word. Anyway, so I always have a love for kind of the paradise and just whole Hawaiian theme. So yeah, I love running around Delfino Plaza, and it was just so cool, and the music, and It's just, it felt big. And you know, again, at the time, it was like, wow, this is really neat. Something that simply could not exist on the N64. There's just no way. Yeah, it was fun. You know, of course, I love Wind Waker. It was amazing, I thought, on the GameCube. Such a good game. I really enjoyed playing that. Yeah, it had some really good games in there. Actually, Resident Evil 4, I think that was GameCube, wasn't it?
Oh, yeah. That's one of my favorite games of all time.
That was amazing. I kind of get mixed up because they ported to the Wii and then the Wii U and one another Wii U.
Pretty sure that's a port on the GameCom. I mean, that thing is on everything.
Yeah, that was such a milestone in kind of camera control, like that kind of that weird kind of third person, first person kind of hybrid. You know, I guess the pre kind of Gears of War kind of camera was really neat, over the shoulder. It was one of the first times, if not the first time, certainly the first time I played it anyway. I think it was the first game that did that, I don't know, but it was pretty special at the time. So yeah, the GameCube had some very special events.
Oh yeah, I mean, even in terms of the violence, like that first time that the villager with the potato sack on his head cut my head off in the village, I just dropped the controller like, what did I just see?
Yeah, it was awesome. Because the perspective, it was just so amazing for a Resident Evil game, you know? Because the ones on the N64 were just blocky, you know? It was hard to... I mean, they were decent, but, you know...
I'm surprised that Capcom or Nintendo coughed up the money to put enough memory on that cartridge to cram, you know, a two-disc game onto an N64 cartridge. It's like, who paid for that?
Yeah, totally. Totally crazy. Anyways, we get it next. I mean, it's going to be exciting to see. Like, is it this hybrid kind of handheld home console thing that it's rumored to be? And if that's the case, how on earth does that work? You know, is it? There have been some rumors where there's like the main game, you know, runs on the console when you're at home kind of thing. But then if you leave the house with the remote unit, whatever it's called, then is that a full experience of what you would play at home, but now just on the go, or is it slightly less experience than that for whatever reason, because it doesn't have as much hardware capability on the mobile? And if that's the case, well, that's weird. What does that mean for each game? What does that also mean for developers? Do they have to make different, you know, a different sliver of the game for that? You know, so there's a lot of maybes, a lot of speculation. It's going to be fascinating to find out. I mean, not that we'll find out the facts of that tomorrow necessarily. We'll just find out hopefully the concept of what it is tomorrow. But yeah, really, really interesting stuff. But that's cleanly going to... Sorry, go ahead.
Please finish. I can wait.
I was just going to say, I think it's going to cleanly just end the life of the 3DS as soon as the NX comes out. I think the 3DS will be dead.
And I'm hopeful that for people like yourself and other companies, I'm pretty sure they'll have some sort of communication. But they'd be wise to be ready with communication for people to say, okay, here's how you can port your stuff over. Or they need to have that ready. I hope they've done their homework.
Yeah, hopefully they'll have things like Unity or Unreal ready, you know, at launch or soon after launch, because that's a big deal. A lot of people are using those two engines now, you know, and they already allow you to release your game on multiple platforms already. So being able to just, not for free, but just with some extra work, but not a whole new game's extra work, get it working on a brand new machine like the NX, that'd be pretty awesome. And can the 3DS, for example, can it communicate with the NX in any way?
Mm-hmm. That would be amazing. You know, I don't play my Wii U a ton, but I enjoy it.
Indeed.
Stuff I play on it, I enjoy it, you know?
Yeah. I mean, the Wii U is dead. I mean, as far as I think for them and them making money and them putting any stock in that, I don't think they are. I think in their eyes, that was fun. We did some good stuff. All right, that's dead. Let's I wouldn't be surprised if they do a lot of enhanced version of their Wii U games for the NX, because they made some wonderful games for the Wii U. But unfortunately, not many people have played them, you know, in the world. I mean, you and I have played 12, them, and probably everyone who's listening to this has probably played it.
Maybe 14 million people, I guess, have Wii U.
Something like that, yeah. You know, which obviously is a lot, but not really. Not in the grand scheme of things when it comes to a video game. platforms. So yeah, it'd be nice to kind of move a lot of those over. I liked Super Mario 3D World. I thought that was really fun. Oh, Splatoon, of course, is wonderful.
Rumbo is one of my favorites.
Rumbo, yeah. Donkey Kong. I mean, there's lots of great games for the Wii U. It's a really, really good games. The HD version of Wind Waker was amazing. Some really nice stuff. Yeah, so it'd be really cool to see that. That stuff move over to the NX, but they, you know, they don't want to flood it with a bunch of ports, but for over its life cycle, it would be nice to see that anyway. Just a special edition.
To provide a path, though, would be good. So as a developer, what are like your like top, I don't know, top three, top five things that like you definitely want to see as a developer? And you mentioned Unity. What's one of the things that you really want to see make it more enticing for you to continue developing for that platform, which is, I guess, going to be handheld and console together
in theory, right? Yeah. I mean, Unity is neat. I mean, obviously we have used that in the past. We use that to make Touch the Goat and stuff like that, so we've used it, and it's a really neat engine. It's very flexible. You can really get in there and, you know, adjust stuff. It's really nice. It's quite powerful. It has a big overhead, so on the 3DS, new 3DS for example, it's not great to use for, but for a more powerful machine, it can be really good. What do I hope for? That's an interesting question. I guess a really robust and fun and accessible eShop would be the biggest thing for me, because I just want the biggest problem, I think, with the 3DS and or the Wii U is people getting access to the eShop. Like, you and I can do it, no problem, it's easy, yeah, whatever. But the average casual gamer, I think it's quite challenging to figure out what the hell is the eShop, how do I even get there, and how do I buy something, and is this what I'm just gonna, some people don't even know it exists. They just go to GameStop or Best Buy or Target or Walmart or whatever. That's where the games are. You know, they don't think that even has an eShop on there, and that's horrifying to think that a huge percentage of people that own the 3DS, for example, don't even know that eShop exists. That's a huge problem for people like me, that I want to sell my games electronically, digitally. You know, I mean, I love retail, of course, but that's a completely different ball game. I get to use another baseball reference. What's going on with that? But, you know, it's a completely different market to get into the whole retail space, and it's really challenging, and it's just got worse over the years. More challenging, unfortunately, more competitive. But, yes, that's the biggest thing for me, is really easy to get to the store. Like, I think the Sony store, like from the Vita, is just a little bit easier. You know, you load up the Vita, there's the PSN store icon, you touch it, it takes you there. I don't remember the 3DS eShop store being that easy. I remember the first time being like, oh, where is it? And then you have to, like, I think it requires you to have, well, this was before Nintendo Network ID even existed. So that may have been a reason as well. Like, it was pre that account system, so that probably didn't help. So maybe now, if you've got a 3DS and jump into the eShop, maybe it's a little bit easier, maybe, than it was when the 3DS first came out.
I'm having a difficult time remembering what it was like before. I know my icon is right there, like in the upper left, sort of.
And I just remember thinking, God, people are going to find this really tough. Because I can't remember what the problem was now, but yeah, it was before Nintendo Network ID existed. But you had to create an account. Was it tied to your friend's code? Gosh, I can't even remember now. I remember it being a little weird. Anyway, whatever. But the problem, but the bigger problem though was Nintendo was still making money from retail, so they didn't want to just flood everyone over to the eShop, you know, because they still want people to go to GameStop, etc., and buy their games because that's where they make a lot of money. So I didn't feel like there was a huge push to educate like your average Nintendo gamer to be like, hey, go to the eShop. You know, there wasn't a huge push for that. There was a medium push for that. Whereas I think with Sony, for example, or Xbox, there's a much bigger push for them to get on their digital stores. Much bigger, much more integrated it feels. Like you turn on the system and you're in the store practically, you know. Whereas with 3DS,
it's a double-edged sword though. You know, people, you know what it is, maybe it's the people that are, you know, people who are enthusiasts are complaining about it, you know. The store, I don't like these ads, I don't like the store being, I mean, how do you feel about Nintendo just silently putting demos and things just on your system? Does that, do you like that?
I don't actually. I guess I should turn that off. No, I'm not a huge fan of that.
I'm not either.
I need to turn it off. Because it happens to me and I'm like, yeah, I don't really want that. I delete it. And I'm like, I should go to the settings and turn that off, shouldn't I? I never do.
Can
that.
You? I don't know. I'm assuming
I think you can. Yeah. Okay. I think you can.
I probably should do the same thing. I don't really appreciate it either.
No, it's annoying. But I mean, just for me, from a business perspective, though, I'd like the eShop to be seamless. Like, boom, I turn on my machine, and if Nintendo are interested in pimping out my latest game, boom, it hits you in the face as soon as you turn on your machine. That would be amazing. That would make a big difference.
That was my next question. It's just like Nintendo called you and said, "Hey, Jules, why don't we put your game? We're gonna send your game a demo to everybody." You were like, "Yeah, okay, good."
Yeah, go ahead. I would not say no to that.
Don't send it
even
to
the ones
me.
Who have that turned off. Yeah, just overwrite that and just put it on their machine anyway.
You know, no matter what they have. Yeah,
just say sorry later. Ask for forgiveness later. Totally. No, but yeah, so that's the big thing. But no, I mean, I have faith in Nintendo. I think it's going to be a really good hardware. I think it'll have good buttons, good sticks, etc. You know, I think the Wii U gamepad out of the gate was pretty decent, you know. I thought the first 3DS iteration was pretty good. I think the new 3DS, not XL, the smaller one, is wonderful. I love it. The smaller new 3DS, I think, is really, really sweet. I think I like that it has the matte finish and the buttons and everything feel really, really nice. I like the faceplates.
I was wondering if it was the faceplate. I have the larger one.
I have that too, and I do not like it. The large XL, the new XL, I dislike it quite a lot. Oh. I got it. I was super excited, and I got the back off to switch out the SD card for a bigger one. And it freaking busted the back, man. I mean, I was super careful.
You have
it to broke
like
the back.
Make sure you lift that ridge.
Like, oh, I know exactly. It's that bottom. Oh, what a nightmare! I even sent it to Nintendo to fix it. They sent it back. Did nothing. It took weeks as well. I was like, thanks for nothing. That's great. Anyway, so what else was there? It has the gloss finish, which I'm not a huge fan of, so it's really kind of looks smudgy a lot of the times. And there was another aspect. There's a few things I didn't like about the XL, but as soon as I got my hands on the new 3DS, the smaller one, I was like, yep, this is it for me. This is perfect. Perfect size, perfect matte finish. Getting the SD card is a lot easier. You can have the faceplates, which is awesome. I like it a lot. I got the white one with the multicolored face buttons, like the SNES in a way. Really nice. I like it a lot.
Yeah, I don't know why they didn't give the... I mean, I know the actual... the color of the letters are the Super color, Famicom colors, but why didn't they just go all the way and give us the buttons?
That would look so good. That would look so good on that machine, wouldn't it?
Let's pull it back a step further to say, what made them think purple was the way to go with the Super Nintendo? Like, what were they thinking?
Yeah, that is
Americans
so ugly.
Love purple.
That's the worst design choice ever. This Super Nintendo in the States is so ugly. Such a brick.
I don't get it.
Because the Famicom is beautiful. We got that in Europe as well. That was the SNES in Europe. And that's what I grew up with. I mean, it was beautiful. And I saw the American one. I'm like, why would you do that? Who would decide? I mean, why would you do that? So bad. I mean, that was the 80s, I guess. And it was just, or early 90s, whenever. Late 80s, early 90s, whatever it was. And it was just that bigger, boxier, kind of macho, I don't know. That is a faux pas. They messed up. It was a terrible idea. But, yeah, so, you know, so I think the NX is going to be nice. So I have faith that the physical design will be good. But yeah, I think for me, the only big thing I can think of is just the eShop being integrated in a nice way. Because that just, affects me directly. Beyond that, you know, I just want Nintendo to do their typical awesome in kind of executing a really nice design, you know. And hopefully they have really great games on it. So people buy it.
People are excited, and I fully expect them to not let you down or let all of us down, because people are hyped. I guess for Nintendo, people are saying, you know, they missed the sweet spot. You know, it's coming out in March. Supposedly, they haven't announced a delay. What are they doing? But to be honest with you, they could actually pull a Sega Saturn and get away with it.
Yeah,
in the long run, I don't know. Yeah. But up front, people will be so excited they just walk off the job. You know, I'm going to get the NX. Yeah. So.
I mean, I think despite what they show tomorrow, even if it's a bit odd and strange, which it might be, and it certainly won't live up to the hype that this build-up has generated. I think it's impossible. But I think despite all of that, even if it seems a bit strange tomorrow and has some negative reactions in some way, which I don't know, I'm just, that's the way the world is. I think based on what I assume they've done, based on the timing and just their efforts and how their focus has kind of definitely, you know, shifted off of Wii U and onto seemingly NX, I think they'll probably have a pretty great lineup next year. I anticipate they'll have at least three games in 2017 for the NX. So, and that's what you need, you know, regardless of the hardware, as long as it's not a complete lame duck. I think as long as you have at least two amazing games, then you'll be set, you know. And I think the nice thing is they get to do kind of a launch at a really strange time of year, you know, in March. It's a very strange time of year to launch something, but it's fine. It's not like bad, but it's not. It's weird. But I think what they could do is they could launch something there with a really strong lineup, at least one amazing first party ish game. And the nice thing is they could really, really hit it home with the holiday season that year as well. With an amazing, you know, kind of follow up. And this isn't even counting Zelda. I mean, we all know Zelda's happening. So that's out of the picture. It's like, yeah, that's going to be great. Awesome. That's old news now. It's going to be awesome. It'll be fun.
And that's something beyond a while, correct?
Right. Something like that, yeah. But I think they'll have something which isn't that, I think, at launch or soon close to launch, and then probably have something pretty amazing at Christmas. But then if they have anything in between that, awesome. I mean, they will probably need to have something in summer as well.
I'd like Quest 64 too. I mean, if I'm being honest here, I think it's about time.
Quest 64, what's that? I'm not familiar with that.
Oh, it was I think it was the first RPG for the N64.
Oh right, it's called Quest 64.
Quest 64. It's not very good.
It's not very good. All right, do you do a revamp for the NX, Quest NX, or whatever they're going to call it?
Quest NX 128.
There you go. Nice. But actually, talking about Zelda real quick, it's like the videos I've seen recently have kind of turned me off actually a little bit from that game, because it's looking more and more like Monster Hunter, which obviously, you know, that's a very popular game and it's very good in its own right. You know, I've tried to play it and I'm like, wow, I don't have the time to play that game.
I don't have the patience, really, the skill.
No, I don't. Just, yeah. No, I just don't have, you know, I'm like, no, this doesn't fit my... what I have available right now, so I'm not going to do it. But it looks more and more like that, and I'm sure it's not, but I can't help but draw the comparisons when I see the trailers for it, and him cooking up the food and eating the food, and this whole kind of deeper inventory and using food for health. I don't know how deep that goes, but I can only assume that then maybe translates to the weapons and all kinds of stuff, and that's not a bad thing. That's great to try something new, but it's not what I want from Zelda, so I'm hoping it doesn't go too far down that road. But if it does, that's cool. I mean, it'd be different. I'm sure everyone will love it.
But Jules, can you keep a secret? I'll let you in on a little something.
Okay. Yeah, sure. I'm listening.
When they were talking about this game being 30, 40, 50 hours,
Is it really? Wow.
I don't know. I know they're saying it's a much bigger game. Said? And I'm thinking, I don't really know if I want to. I mean, I got bored. I walked away from Skyward Sword, like, almost in the tutorial, because I was just like, this is dragging, you right. know?
Yeah.
But then again, I have to go back to like Twilight Princess. That came out during the Wii's launch, and it was also released for the GameCube as well, but I got it for the Wii. And your tolerance during a launch is much different than your tolerance midway at any other point in a console's life cycle.
Yeah.
So I feel like maybe I will be patient enough to stick with it if it's that in depth, because normally I have gaming ADD. I try to play as many games as possible because I'm crazy. Right. So.
Yeah. Well, and who knows how many games they'll be out, you know? If the NX launches with Zelda and that's it for like 2 weeks, a month, whatever, then cool. It gives everyone plenty of time to to get into Zelda. Yeah. Which,
for better or for worse, but yeah.
Yeah, it may not be a great idea to do that, but because not everyone wants to play that. But yeah, no, it'll be interesting. I'm super excited. I mean, developing aside, because I don't know anything about it as far as that, but as a player, very excited to see what it is. I mean, I love handheld gaming over anything anyway. So that's definitely my what I go to. You know, actually, it's not on that note, I recently got a new Vita, a Japanese import. It's neon orange. It is awesome, dude. It's so sweet. So, yeah, new Vita a couple of weeks ago. I've been getting into that.
So this is not the, and this is the newer model, not the OLED original model.
No, it is OLED actually. I didn't think it would be. It's kind of this weird hybrid between the two because it's slightly smaller, a bit smoother around the edges. So it's, I've got the original as well, like the black original Vita. It's great. It's fine. But I made the mistake of going to Amazon just kind of browsing one time. And I came across this neon orange Japanese import Vita, and I'm like, oh my gosh. And I've got the, you know, they have the pictures where you can zoom in and see them, and it's like, oh, it's all smooth and stuff. I'm like, oh my gosh, that looks awesome. I was like, well, that's such an extravagant gift to myself. But I had to get it, so I got it. It was terrible. But, and it's awesome, dude. Yeah, it's a weird hybrid between the two. I was thinking it wouldn't be the OLED kind of screen, but it is. And it has the smooth kind of edges and stuff, so it's a nice hybrid between the two.
I always heard that that was the negative aspect of the newer model, was that the screen was not as, the quality wasn't there. But then there are other improvements, like you can charge it with a micro SD,
right?
A micro USB, and then the buttons. I never liked the way the buttons are concave. Never made sense to me on the first model.
Right,
they're hard to press.
Yeah,
like first world problems, hard to press. Really hard to press.
Exactly. But no, it's nice, man. I like it a lot. I was all prepared for the regular backlit screen because I was like, great, it'll be lighter, it'll have longer battery life, whatever. You know, it that's okay. But no, it does have that screen, and it's like, wow. And if it's not, it's really close. I mean, maybe I'm just kidding myself, but it looks like the same screen to me. It's awesome. It's beautiful. No, I like it a lot. So I've been getting into that. So I love handheld gaming. So, I mean, so for me, the NX is right up my alley, you know, a handheld, new handheld.
Assuming that someone that you live with and care about doesn't, you know, take it with them. Because
right.
who is the NX? I brought it to work.
We'll be getting multiple NXs if that's the case. And that'll be interesting, right? Like, is the mobile aspect separate, and can you get multiple mobile aspects, or can you get, I mean, you can obviously get extra controllers, but then how does that work, you know?
Yeah,
that's very strange. I don't know how. We'll find out.
And I hope that they explain it, because I mean, you probably know as well as I do that people thought the Wii U was an attachment, an accessory to the Wii.
I did too. I thought, I mean, when I first saw it, I thought at least I could take that with me, even though it's a massive, ugly, bulky iPad. I was like, great, maybe that's what they're doing, but no, it's not. But I guess when you think about it, if the rumor that the controls are detachable from the handheld unit, then perhaps, I don't know, what does that mean, right? I mean, I don't know, maybe the, I don't know what that means. I don't know. I guess we'll find out. Like, yeah, does every game have to rely on a minimum button set like the Wii did with the Wiimote, which was just two buttons and a stick?
They got to get that messaging right. Like, the first, they can't do what Microsoft did or what they did with the Wii U. They got to get it right. This is what it is. They got to think it all out, lay it out, and not make it complicated.
They've definitely done that this time, without a doubt. I mean, they are absolutely, being very careful. Because I do feel like, you know, there obviously were mistakes made with the Wii U, and I think they're like, all right, we're going to do this right. So whether they will or not, obviously, remains to be seen. But I definitely get the sense that, they're really, going to try and do this one right. So, it's going to be fascinating. Not an easy thing to do. It's going to be really fun to kind of be a part of this and see what on earth happens.
So this is probably a silly thing to, like, to go back to. But for the people who don't know, like, I mean, you've mentioned the games that you worked on, but people who don't know kind of where you got your start, would you just mind kind of going back and just recapping, like, how you got to start, like, work your way up to Renegade Kid?
Yeah, sure. So I started actually on the journalist side, and I think it was like 91, when I was about, I don't know, 16, 17, something like about that age, as a trainee staff writer. So I got a job there at a video game magazine in London that covered Amiga, Commodore Amiga games. That was the big kind of computer game system in England at the time. And worked there for a year, and I was working on my kind of art portfolio, pixel pushing at the time. So I created a portfolio, which at the time actually was on a 3.5-inch floppy disk. This is pre-internet, pre-email. So I sent my, physically, literally in the mail, sent my portfolio to a video game developer in London and got a job there. So and I worked there for a year as a pixel artist. So I got to work on the NES and the Super Nintendo. This was in 92, probably. So I worked there for a year, and then I applied for a job at Iguana, who was in Northern England and also in the States. But at the time, I was applying at the England studio, and I got the job there. And they said, "Hey, we'll send over to the HQ studio in the US for 3 months to train, and then you can come back and then start, you know, then." Because I was, you know, I was still young and inexperienced, and I'm like, "Yeah, great, awesome, 3 month vacation sounds good to me." Always wanted to go to the States, so yeah, why not? So that was in California at the time, Northern California, Sunnyvale, and really just never really talked about going back to England. So that was weird. So that was in 93. I was about 19 at the time. 19, I think, yeah. And then the company actually moved down to Texas the same year that I came over, and I was like, sure, whatever. So the company moved down to Austin, Texas, and I've been here ever since. I was with Iguana. Well, Iguana was later bought by Acclaim, and I worked there initially as a pixel artist. Like I say, this was in the Super Nintendo, Genesis kind of days, and then all the way through through as far as Nintendo platforms, you know, N64. GameCube, and then one of the last games we worked on there is in 2004-ish, and that was probably like PS2 kind of Xbox kind of, I was going to say Xbox One, the first Xbox kind of era. I think it was pre-360 and so on, I don't know, something like that. The Acclaim closed in 2004. I did some freelance stuff for a while. I worked at a place called King's Isle for about 18 months. They did a kids MMO game called Wizard 101, and then went on to do Pirates 101.
I've seen commercials for that on G4 TV all the time.
Yeah, no, it's amazing. They had quite a budget. Yeah, I know. It's like, wow, they're doing TV commercials. It's amazing. So I was the producer on that project, on the Wizard 101 one. And then Greg and I were... Yeah, Greg was there too. Actually, Greg was at Iguana as well. That's when... You know, we met, and he was the art manager, and I was the producer, and we both left that job. We had a decent salary, and we had no good reason to leave, but we'd wanted to start our own company for so long, and we're like, you know, let's do it, you know. So we decided to leave and start Renegade Kid in 2000. Well, it must have been probably 2006, but you know, Dementium didn't come out until 2007. And that's when we started Renegade Kid in 2007.
All right.
Boom. Wow. So that's the relatively quick, I guess, version of many years.
So did you work on Turok? Unless you were at Iguana.
I worked on Turok 2.
Turok 2? Oh, Seeds of Evil.
Oh. Seeds of Evil, yes. I did some multiplayer maps for that, which is really fun. Because, I mean, multiplayer, first-person... multiplayer games, you know, that genre was relatively new at the time, certainly on N64, or anyway, brand new on N64. That was really fun as a designer. So at Acclaim and Iguana while I was there, I went from being, you know, pixel artist through lots of different roles, you know, including producer and designer, game director, later became creative director and stuff like that. So, when Turok 2, when I was working on that, I was a designer. And that was fun, yeah. Like, designing the multiplayer maps and just kind of researching that, you know, from some of the PC games and what, you know, Quake and stuff like that, like what were they doing and what worked well and how can we let that inspire us to make stuff for Turok 2. So yeah, it was fun, man. Really fun. Yeah, it was an interesting studio. I mean, I was there for, gosh, like 13 years or something.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, it was a really long stretch. So, yeah, from 93... what was it, 13 years? Or maybe it was just 11. I don't know. I think it was... Yeah, it must have been from like 1993 to 2004. So maybe it was 11 years. Sorry, I think it was 11 years. I don't know where I got 13 from. Wow. But, yeah, 11 years, I think. And it was my college years, you know. It was just like, you know, there's people, everyone was young and just single and hanging out. It was just super fun and everyone loved making games. And obviously in the evenings, we'd all just party together and drink and play games. You know, that, I remember the, especially when we first moved down to Austin, you know, that's when we would play Mario Kart on the Super Nintendo all of the time. You know, I had my roommate, we both worked at Iguana, and we'd have friends over who also worked at Iguana, and all be playing, you know, Mario Kart while drinking beers. And it was awesome. It was a really fun, fun time. And everyone was pretty safe, actually. I mean, yeah, we were drinking and hanging out, but no one did anything totally crazy. So it was actually pretty safe times, but it was super fun. So yeah, it was a good, really nice chapter of my life that feels like a lifetime ago now, but it was super fun. It was really good.
Do you remember the first time that you saw the cerebral boar in Turok 2? What was your reaction?
Yeah. No, it was amazing. Yeah. I mean, they're always pushing the envelope of that game. Even the first game, the animations when they died and stuff was so elaborate, so well done. And it was fully 3D characters, you know, which was pretty fresh at the time. Yeah, they just pushed it to a whole new level with Turok 2. I mean, it was so cool. I mean, what was one of their signatures was coming up with new ridiculous weapons that no one else had come up with. David Denspear, who was the game director, the lead, you know, the brainchild of that game, of those games, was very good, you know, very creative. And he's still a good friend of mine. He's a super great guy, very capable. And he works, gosh, he's a workhorse, man. He lived there practically for many years at the office working on those games. He did a really great job, really put his heart and soul into those games. But yeah, so a lot of those ideas, I don't know if the Super Bowl was his idea or not, but I mean, he came up with the lion's share of those games as far as the ideas and stuff. And yeah, really fun stuff. It was really an exciting time, and that really was Turok and Turok 2, and then Rage Wars, Turok 3. I mean, especially in Turok 1 and Turok 2, that period for Iguana Acclaim was like, yeah, they are our premium games. You know, they are the premium games for this company right now. So there's a lot riding on those games, and they did very well. They're very successful. You know, they made the company a lot of money. yeah, that was fun, man. That was super exciting.
Rage Wars,
you know?
And Turok 3.
Yep.
And,
yeah, it was pretty awesome, man. It was fun, a fun time. But yeah, it was a fun studio to work in. Lots of great times, lots of dramatic, silly times and bad times, but the whole spectrum of emotion in that era. Lots of young people, you know, a lot of people just learning their craft, you know, making mistakes, you know, leadership, trying to get into leadership and making terrible mistakes with, you know, their friends and maybe not friends anymore. And I mean, you were already friends and you joined and someone was promoted to that and suddenly they were their boss now. And oh my gosh, you name it, it happened. It was pretty crazy. Yeah, pretty fun. Lots of stuff learned. Lots of what not to do as well as what to do. Yeah, it's pretty crazy, man. It was good. It was a good time.
I hate to do this to you. You know, you talked about, you know, some of the good times. So I do have to ask this because I do follow you on Twitter. I've seen some of the things you put out there. I know that there were a series of pitches that you made to like Konami to do some reboots and things like that.
Would you
mind kind of giving some more information on some of the ideas that you have that I think people like myself would have loved if these companies had taken it.
Yeah, we did so many pitches, just so many different companies. Because when we started, you know, we did Dementium as just kind of an entry. And my assumption was, well, great, you know, hopefully that'll show that we're capable. and then we'll be able to do, you know, SpongeBob and other licensed games or whatever. Thankfully, that never happened. But I was willing because I thought that's just the way it was, you know. But fortunately, we were able to make a lot of original games. But we did continuously pitch ideas to the different companies. You know, one of them was, you know, we were making Dementium. It was called The Ward at the time. And, you know, we were looking for a publisher, you know, to get it on the shelf because the, you know, digital shops didn't exist then. And, you know, we were just trying to court every publisher, you know, we went to everyone, really. And one of them was Konami. And we're like, hey, we can turn this into a survival horror, I mean, into a Silent Hill game, if you like, you know. And so that was one pitch for that particular game, which they turned us down for, thankfully, actually, in the end. I mean, at the time, it sucked. But it was good that we ended up just doing our own thing. But, you know, some of the games, I mean, you definitely fill in the blanks if I'm not remembering the one that you're referring to.
I thought there was maybe a Castlevania or something else for Konami, I remember. It wasn't Silent Hill, though. It was an older franchise.
Ninja 5-0?
Yep. There you go.
That was one of them. Yeah, we did a kind of a 2.5D version of Ninja 5-0. We had like a little mock-up for that because I love that game. It is such a good. I really like that game. It's quite a gem of a game. So we pitched that. We did a playable demo, 3D playable demo, a 3D platformer of Crash Bandicoot for Activision. We also did a similar 3D third-person demo for Batman for Warner Brothers. There was the Batman Beyond license that ended up, you know, WayForward ended up doing the 2D side-scrolling animated one, which is a beautiful game, so I'm glad they did that. But that's what we were pitching for. We even pitched for Disney to do a Marvel game. They even came down and stuff. Like, we had to pretend we had, like, an office space and stuff like that. It's so funny. So, my wife's uncle has a building up North Austin, so we just pretended that that was our office. We all moved our PCs up there and acted like we totally were working there. All these Disney bigwigs were coming in and we're meeting with them, pretending this is where we worked and stuff. So,
Bluetooth headsets.
It's pretty funny.
Yeah, I'll call you about the deal. Thank you. Yes, yeah. Welcome.
Yeah, that was awesome. That was so funny. We didn't get it, but I don't think it wasn't for want of trying. I mean, I think they just decided to go a different direction for whatever reason. But actually, that project never happened, actually. Yeah, so it's not like someone else got it. It was early on when Disney bought Marvel. So it was one of the initial things. It was like Hulk. Yeah, it was Hulk versus The Thing or something bizarre like that. It was a really strange idea that they, you know, that we had to give them a proposal for their idea. And it was like, this is a very strange idea. It was very odd. Anyway, whatever. But yeah, we do all kinds of different pitches. I'm sure some I'm not even thinking of right now. But yeah, lots and lots of stuff. You know, we always were, you know, and that's part of the reason that we ended Renegade Kid. It was always a struggle financially to kind of, you know, keep the money coming in so we could pay the bills and continue to make games. But it was getting to the point where, you know, we kind of had to fill a few gaps with a few projects that were short or, you know, whatever, to try and keep the money going. And, you know, that's a cycle. If you get stuck in that, you end up making games that are not good, basically. And that's not, you know, no one wants to go there. So I think we kind of pulled the plug before we got to that point. Just seeing the writing on the wall was like, yeah, you know. So we were always pitching to publishers, and it got increasingly more and more difficult as the years went by. And I think as you saw the rise of digital stores and the decline of retail, publishers were getting even more and more kind of picky about stuff, to the point where, wow, you just couldn't get anything landed with anyone. It was crazy, man.
The indie renaissance, it all...
You know. Yeah, it really is, which is wonderful. It's amazing to think we can self-publish our own games now. How crazy is that? You know, it wasn't possible when we first started Renegade Kid. It's totally insane.
Speaking of that, I'm curious. The one platform that I don't think you all put anything out for is Microsoft.
No, funnily enough. I mean, because they're not very kind to developers. They're not very open or supportive, weirdly enough. They're all pain in the ass, actually, to be honest. We were first, ironically, we were developing Mutant Muds for the Xbox 360. Like, that's before it was even called Mutant Muds. We were making just a platform game for the 360. Because I had a 360 at the time. I have an Xbox One. I love playing their machines, playing their games. But to work for them, they don't make it easy. That would be the nice way of saying it. They do not make it easy. They make, they put extra barriers up. They're unnecessary, and it's annoying.
And this, like, is not prior to their comeuppance. This is the arrogance of, hey,
exactly,
we're doing well, and then obviously
Xbox One especially.
Xbox One just fell out of the gate.
Yeah, but even 360 though, they're a huge pain in the ass because for us, we're like, great, let's make a digital 360 game. We're making, you know, it wasn't called Mods, but whatever. It ended up being Mods. And then I quickly discovered, wow, we can't even self-publish on there. We either have to go through a publisher, or Nintendo has to graciously select us to be, the, you know, published by them, basically. And it's like, well, okay, that's weird. But Nintendo over here with their 3DS eShop, we can literally self-publish without anyone else being involved. And I love Nintendo, I love the 3DS. Let's go over there. So that's why we moved over there. You know, that I think sense. If they had their doors opened up and there was no obstacles just to get our game on their platform, it would have probably ended up being a 360 game. But because of that, we're like, that's weird. We can't guarantee that we'll even be able to release our game over there. That's ridiculous. Let's release it over on the 3DS then. So that's what we did. And I'm glad we did. And that obviously helped inspire the game itself with the layer jumping and the 3D and all the rest of it. And it really worked out really great. I mean, I'm very happy that happened. But and then the Xbox One, yeah, they've got even worse as far as, you know, if you release the game somewhere else and then you suddenly decide to move it over to Xbox One, then, well, because you've already released it, now you have to add something brand new to your game for it to be worthy for our platform. It's like, well maybe we just won't do it.
Is that a how hard and that? Fast rule?
Okay.
I mean, because I know there's exceptions that they make.
I'm sure there are exceptions. That's
the problem. Either you do it or you don't.
Yes. It's very gray, I'm sure. I mean, maybe it's not a rule now. I mean, honestly, I wouldn't know. I don't bother even trying to do stuff with them anymore, so I don't know.
Yeah, not that whole point, you know?
It's just without... we haven't had the ability to do simultaneous launches of our games. So we just because we're not big enough, we can't afford
not,
to
not
do
jewels.
That.
Come on. Now, you see how well that worked out for Mighty No. 9? Everybody should release something on 19 platforms on one day.
Right. Yikes. but, you know, so the problem is we stagger them, you know, which is not a good idea. It's not ideal at all. But when you do it that way and then suddenly you come to Xbox and they're like, nope, you have to add some new content just for our version. It's like, that's not going to happen.
How are they talking all these? Because I see a lot of games that are finally making their way. I think they must have, like, really laxed that because...
You know what? They may have, though. I mean, exactly. My news is way old. So they may be like, no, it's fine. You can just... You know what? I don't think it is, though. I think they still want parity, what they call parity, as far as, like, if it's going to be on PS4 or anything else, but mainly PS4, and, you know, it has to come out at the same time on Xbox One, or you add some new stuff to the Xbox One version, if it's going to be late. It's like, oh, why? No one cares. That's ridiculous. People just want the game.
Nothing to prove.
Yeah, you're just making it what's already difficult even more difficult. It's already hard to make a game on someone else's platform. Why make it even more challenging? It just gives people a reason not to do it. And it's not like they're winning the race right now. Obviously, PS4 is dominating. So it's like, why are they even doing that? And like I said, maybe they're not anymore. Maybe you're right. Maybe they've laxed on that. But anyway, that has been my understanding of it. But in the future, though, I would love to do multi-platform. And I think releasing games at the same time, if you can do it, is the way to do it, for sure. If you can plan and do your thing properly, so each platform doesn't, you know, isn't a complete nightmare and destroys the project like Mighty No. 9, then it is the way to go. Because the problems we've had with, like, Muds and Zero Drifter is when we release it later on a different platform, even if it's, like, 3DS first and then Wii U later or Steam later or PS4 later or whatever, when that later comes, no one cares. Like, the press don't care, so they won't review it or cover it, because it's old news, it's an old port. The manufacturer, like Sony or Steam or whoever, they don't care, it's an old port. So then suddenly you get no press or no exposure to this release, and no one cares, therefore it doesn't sell. So you're like, wow. So you kind of have to go multi-platform, unfortunately. Because then everyone's reviewing it, everyone's covering it all at the same time, and you can buy it anywhere. So you really multiply the potential sales and exposure a great deal. So that's the hope.
I guess I looked at it differently. Obviously, you have a very different perception of it. I looked at it like a game comes out, people cover it. But then if it comes out for another system, isn't there some kind of a spike, even if it's not as big as the initial one? Okay.
It's tiny, though. For us, it's been tiny. And, you know, sure, we could do a better job at promoting ourselves and, you know, and marketing and all the rest of it, for sure. We have a lot we could do to improve that. But, you know, when it's just left to the simple fact of, hey, Sony website, we've got our game coming out that was on the 3DS, now it's come on the PS4. Do you care? Not really? Oh, okay, cool. All right, then. Or maybe they do review it, but it doesn't, you know, or they don't. Or they just simply do not review it, you know, because they're just not interested. It's an old game. It's so weird. But yeah, it has definitely been an extra challenge. So, anyway, something we're going to try and hopefully do a little bit differently in the future if we are able to do so.
So I guess obviously developing Chicken Wiggle right now is taking up the lion's share of your time. So when you're not developing games, what are you up to?
I am developing games most of the time right now. So not right much now. Sleeping, I guess. I am playing some games. Like I said, I got my Vita recently. My new Vita again. So that was fun. That kind of renewed my interest in that. And I really went searching for stuff. I got Fez for the Vita. I mean, not a particularly new game for the Vita, but and I got it a long time ago for...
Was it Games with Gold? Oh, not Games with Gold. PlayStation Plus, was it one of those?
No, I just bought it.
Oh.
No, I just got it. I mean, I just searched through what are games on Vita. I didn't look at what was... No, I'm not a PS Plus member. I was for a while, and I wasn't using it enough, so I felt like I was kind of wasting money there for a little bit. And ironically, actually, because when I was the PS Plus member, that's when Zero Drifter was free for Plus members. So that's actually how I got the copy, because why not? And now I can't even play that. I mean, obviously I have a physical, I have codes I could download if I needed to. But now that copy I have on my Vita doesn't even work, because I'm not a Plus member right now. So anyway.
I'm a hoarder. I feel like if they're offering something for free, I just go to the Sony store website and just attach everything to my account, whether I download it or not.
Oh, right, yeah.
But, I mean, obviously all the PS3 stuff probably, I shouldn't say probably never, but... might not get revisited.
yeah. But no, so Fez, I mean, I first played that, I think it was on 360 or maybe Steam, but, you know, I got that on the Vita, really enjoyed it. I mean, I haven't beat it or anything, but I got pretty far, actually. That was fun. That really works well on the Vita. It looks beautiful, sounds great, fun little game there. So that was cool. So I played that. I got Aqua Kitty DX for the Vita, which is Oh, cool. Well, you know exactly what it is. Super game, right? Did you like it?
It's fun. And that's made by... what's the name of the developer?
Dugan, or what is it? That's his name, maybe, but...
Dugan sounds about right.
Yeah, that's his name, isn't it? Is that the name of the company? I'm going to type it in real quick.
This is like Defender, right?
Tiki Pod. Is it Tiki Pod? Tiki Pod.
There you go.
Tiki Pod. But his name is Dugan.
Yes.
I think. Yeah, we follow each other on Twitter. So... yeah, exactly. It's kind of Defender-esque. Yeah, pretty much. It's really nice. I love the pixel art. It's really well balanced. I was actually really quite addicted to that for a little while, where it was like, if I just need a few minutes, just a quick fix kind of thing, I'll just jump in there and kind of make some progress. Yeah, really fun game. And like super cheap as well. Very affordable. It's a bargain. Great. It's like it's under $10, I think.
It is a good
really
game.
Affordable. Really good game. Anyway, so I've been playing that. I really enjoyed that. Again, that I also had that on Steam, I think. And again, it didn't... I don't know. I just don't really play games on that. So I don't know why I buy games over there.
On Steam?
You know, on the Vita. Yeah. So the Vita is a perfect pick. I get to just take it with me and sit on the couch or play it before bed or whatever. You know, it's just so convenient. I love it. That's why I love handhelds. Also got Symphony of the Night, the PS1 version of the game, but on the Vita. So that was cool. It's fun playing through that again as well. Beautiful pixel artwork. So that was fun. Been playing some of that. Also, last game I mentioned on the 3DS, Chase Cold Case Investigations Distant Memories, the longest title ever.
It rolls right off the tongue.
I know, right? It really is very catchy. And that's cool. Have you played that? Have you seen that? Do you know what that is?
I have not seen that. Is that like, that's not like a one of those, like, I don't want to say pixel hunt, but like investigative kind of.
It is. It's an investigative. It's eShop only, I think. And it is. It's actually by the same team that did. Oh my gosh! I had that in my brain. It just went. It was a DS game. Super good. Oh my gosh! The name just went out of my head. So frustrating.
I'll search for it in a sec. Dusk.
Thank you. I think it was.
I own Hotel Dusk. I used to hate nicely when I would get done those conversations and then I would fail.
I think that's exactly what it is. So it's kind of, yeah, it's kind of similar to that. Really, it's got a lot of similarities in a way to, oh my gosh, my brain is not working. The Capcom lawyer game.
Oh, Phoenix Wright. Or,
thank you. My God.
What was the other one? Edge? Miles
Ace,
Edgeworth or
blah,
Ace?
Blah, whatever it is. Yeah. Ace, blah, blah, Phoenix. Whatever.
Phoenix Wright, Ace
anyway,
Attorney.
Anyway, the Ace Attorney, thank you. So it has a vibe of that as well. Really nice artwork. But really short. It's like $5, $6, $7, something like that. Pretty $6.99, I think. It's pretty short. But yeah, it's fun. Good little story. And I mean, you can't really lose it. I mean, I guess you can if you really aren't paying attention. But it's just a fun interactive story, really. Yeah, really well done. So I enjoyed that. That was nice. I beat it. I mean, I was in one sitting. I mean, it's not hard to do.
Oh, wow.
It's very short. It's just a little kind of snack of a game. And I get the, hopefully I get the impression they're going to do a bunch of those, which I would love. I mean, they're fun little games. So yeah, they're a Cold Case Investigation. So hopefully we'll do another one soon. But no, I enjoyed it. It was very well done. How about you? What have you been up to?
Oh, wow. like I mentioned earlier, I tried to play too much. Well, I did pick up the PlayStation VR last week.
Oh, yeah. How was that, man?
And well, it's funny. I brought it up to the home office. I'm getting the box open, and my 10 and 7-year-old are there watching me. I open the box up, and I tell them what it is. And like 2 seconds later, they were both fighting over...
Oh, I bet.
A piece
oh my gosh.
Of... Oh, wait for it. Oh. You'll love this. They were fighting over the bubble wrap.
Oh.
That secured the box.
Oh my gosh. I don't care about the awesome sci-fi headsets in there. That's one of the bubbles, yeah.
They
oh
smashed it. I think the 7-year-old smashed it out. Because she likes to just stomp on it and hear the pop.
I do like that too.
So
it's hard to resist.
They fought over that. I was just like, that's funny. Awesome.
You're like, great, I'll be over here enjoying the...
Yeah, I did. She calls it the cyber helmet. So
yes. It's a cool looking.
It
I haven't
pretty cool.
seen it in person. I haven't used it, but it looks slick. It looks really nice.
It is fun, and I, you know, if I were I to get it for my PC, I'd need to upgrade the graphics card, and then buy the actual Vive or Oculus. And I just, you know, that's, no, that's, you know, they're not giving those
that's
away.
That's a hassle. Yeah.
So. I do a lot of PC games. I don't mind playing on my PC. Yeah. It's just
right.
That's a much it's bigger a, investment.
Oh yeah,
than PlayStation VR.
Yeah. The PSVR is that's a great. It's a great thing that has happened because it's a very accessible VR.
Yeah.
And that's been anyway. So how was it? How has your experience been playing the
a lot
the
of
experiences
fun.
Games or whatever? What have you played so far?
Okay, well let's see. The first thing I think I believe I played was Thumper.
Oh yeah, I've heard about that. Okay, so what is that?
Well, Thumper, what do they call it? It's like
a puzzle type game, or not a puzzle.
It's sort of on a like you're on a rail.
On a rail. Okay.
It's a what they call it, a rhythm violence game. I think some of the guys.
So it's a rhythm based experience. Okay.
So you're like on a track, like you're just like this metal beetle looking thing, and you're on a track going in, like going into the screen, and. There's these obstacles that you have to like.
And it looks crazy awesome, right? Because you're in VR, so you're like, you're totally it's there.
Very immersive, and you get 3D audio, whatever that really means, through the headset. So even though the little earbuds that come with it are kind of cheap,
there's 3D sound as well.
Yeah, it works. Nice. Like I sat the 16-year-old down, and she was like, "Dad, this is so cool."
Yeah,
she was like, "This is crazy."
VR is amazing. Like I saw a demo. This was one of the PC ones. I don't know which one it was. The headsets, I mean. And it was a demo, and you were standing underwater on a big sunken wrecked boat ship thing, shipwreck underwater, and you're just standing there on the bow or whatever, and it, you know, it's active, it's alive, you're underwater, a lot of fish going by and stuff like that, and this ginormous whale just swims by, and it's freaky, dude. It's actually makes you anxious. Because you feel like this freaking ginormous whale is swimming right past you. Like the size of, like, freaking, I don't even know how many houses. Like, ginormous. You know, and you, this massive eyeball is looking right at you. And that's it. All you're doing is standing there. And that's all you're doing. And with the sound and the sense of scale was like, oh my gosh. And that was amazing. And I'm like, wow, if that is effective, essentially doing nothing, if that's effective, I can only imagine if you're actually doing a game and actually doing something, how that could be amazing. Because what I was doing is standing there. So that's been my experience with VR, and that was very impressive. I was like, wow.
I guess before this, I haven't done a whole lot. I tried it out briefly at PAX. Tiny had one of the dev kits for, you know, Oculus. My experience has been somewhat limited. I took the kids to a local library, and they had... Oh, what's the company? It's not really even a competitor. I forgot what company has their own. Another PC flavor. VR flavor. But anyway, the Thumper was real cool. I mean, you're on this track, and there's actually boss battles. They like, they kind of throw these lights at you, and you have to like hit the button on the beat. And you kind of, it never gets old how you kind of absorb the projectile, and then you shoot it back out on the track, and you watch it just wind its way and like explode. It just is really cool. I really enjoyed Thumper.
Nice. Harmonix. How much is that? Do you know? Is that a disc game? Was it on the digital or what is that?
It's digital. I think it's digital only. I suspect that like a limited run, that would be a perfect candidate for like a limited run kind of thing.
Yeah. How much was that on the store?
I got it for review, but I think it's 15 or 20. No more than 20. So it's reasonable. Yeah. I'm glad you asked that because I was finishing up my Super Hypercube review. I don't know if you've seen Super Hypercube.
No, I'm familiar with that. It's from the Hex guy? No, what the heck? What's it called? Is it by the guy who did...
Fez, Phil Fish.
Oh, it is?
It's not just his. It's Kokoromi, and I know Polytron was also involved. Oh, so it was Kokoromi.
Okay, no, I was completely on the wrong... Okay, I didn't realize it was from them. Okay, cool. All right, Super Hypercube. Cool.
Yeah, so like you're looking down like a path, you see a hole in a wall, and you want to rotate an object to fit through that hole. But every time you successfully do it, more cubes get grafted on to that original set of two cubes or one cube.
Right.
And it just creates this weird, it creates a bigger and bigger shape that gets more and more difficult for you to determine.
Kind of just squeeze in or whatever you're doing.
And then on top of that, the actual wall begins to rotate. So it gets...
Yeah, wasn't there a game on the iPad like Super Hex or Hex Super whatever by the guy who did VVVV and...
Super Hexagon?
Yeah, is that what it is? Super Hexagon?
You're looking sort of like down like a well almost. Yeah. And you just go through these walls and you can... And then like in the upper right corner, there's a power-up for like a focus meter that you can slow down time and get even more time to figure out your rotation.
You can really squeeze through a cool little...
And if you smash up against it, I think you have like maybe one or two chances. It'll like kind of continue on with the parts that would have made it through anyway, but you've lost points at that point.
Yeah. Okay. So,
but when you mentioned the price of Thumper, I played the game, I captured the video, I did the voiceover, and I'm typing up, you know, this information, the publisher, the price, the platform, yada yada. I'm like, oh, what's the price? And I went to go look, and it was $30.
Wow.
And I thought...
And it's basically a puzzle-type game, right?
Yeah, not that there's anything inherently wrong with that. Like, I paid $30 to Picross, you know, Picross 3D Round 2, but I'll probably put 500 hours into it.
Yeah.
But I thought...
Yeah, that's a tough buy, though. I mean, yeah, something that's kind of a dive in for a few minutes, and yeah. I don't know. It's price is tricky, but $30 does seem a bit steep.
It does, and I know that there's somewhat of a tax on it, on a lot of VR stuff, just because...
If they can, right?
The pool is small, so it's like, we gotta try to hedge our
bets. It probably should be a $15 game, but they're like, yeah, we can push it to $30 because we can.
Like, ultimately, I struggle sometimes with whether or not to mention price, because it's relevant,
I know. It's a tough one.
I guess in hindsight, I'm glad that I did the review. I recorded the VR, I mean, the voiceover without knowing it, because I feel like that would have definitely colored my perception. Did I have fun with the game? Yes. Do I think $30 is reasonable? It's questionable.
Yeah. I mean, I personally think that price is important. In a review, just me personally, I mean, because now games can be priced so variedly. From $1 to $60. I think price is valid, you know, because if a game that costs $10 is just as good as a game that costs $60, well, that's worth mentioning, you know, because that's like, huh, what's up with that? You know, and vice versa. A game that's $60, that's like, wow, that should have been a $5 game. That's awful, you know, and it's. You know, or a game that's just really simple and really basic, it's $1. Well, why would you judge it against a game that costs 10, 20, 30, 40, 50 bucks? It cost you $1. You know, so it's like, you know, I think it is reasonable to be like, dude, it's a $1 game. Does it deliver $1 worth of value? You know, is it fair to judge it against something that costs $10? You know, it's a tough one, man. But you know, I think it is.
I agree with you. You know, we live in a world where people will call out reviewers for, you know, reviews are supposed to be objective. That doesn't even make any sense. How do you review something objectively?
Objective. It's impossible. Yeah.
But people will say stuff like that. Like, no?
Yeah. It's like, how could it be objective? That's the point.
That's why it's a review.
That's a personal opinion of a game.
I tend to try to ask for things for review that I think I like. Now, do I like everything? Yeah, of course. No. But
yeah.
I know. I don't give out scores, and I know that if anybody, the people who do look at the stuff that I put out, they might be thinking, he likes everything. I don't like everything, but I try to find what's enjoyable about everything.
Like, anyway, yeah. I hate that when, like, someone who obviously, even in their bio, says they don't like certain games, or they like these types of games specifically. They probably don't say what they don't like, but they say what they do like, and they're reviewing a game that is not on their like list of genres, and they give it a bad score. You're like, huh. That's weird, because chances are you just don't like that type of game. If it was given to someone that loves that genre, they would have probably scored it higher, because they would see it for what it is in that genre. Like, oh, wow, compared to games of that. So that's a tough one, you know?
I've struggled with that, but I've got a game I thought it would be different. It's like, well, this turned out to be a strategy game. I don't like strategy games, but I've said, I don't like this type of game. However, from the little I do know of this genre, I still feel this is a quality product.
Right, they did a good job
of this genre.
Yeah, it's a tough game. Reviews are tough, man. In a perfect world, you'd have a review, a written review, and a score. Because I like scores from someone who is a fan of that genre, and you'd also have a written review and a score, or at least a score from someone who is not a fan of that genre, just to kind of see where it sits. You know, did it even sway the non-fan? Or no, they still hate it. You know, because it's just not their bag. It'd be good to, because for me, at the end of the day, reviews are about providing information to the potential customer. And as much information, as much of a decision they can make based on what you're providing them, the better. You know, so, I mean, Famitsu, I think, is great because they do like 4 different people. And you get to know the personalities. Not that I don't know them, but people who read that magazine a lot. You get to know the personalities of the different reviewers, and you kind of get to engage. Oh, yeah, this person like gave that a 9. Wow, they really liked it. I wouldn't think they'd like that. That's really cool. That really means something to me, because that person doesn't usually like this genre, because I know they like those genres. That really means a lot. And then the other people gave it a good review as well, or whatever, vice versa. So it's, I don't know, I like the value in that when you have, like, you know, 4 people or 3 or whatever.
See, so like the old 2. EGM, 3 or 4 people on a, no. a review.
I do like that. Yeah, as a reader, it's kind of like you really get a good idea of of what this game's about, you know, because if one person's opinion is kind of meaningless, it means they like it, great, that doesn't mean I'll like it, you know, or they hated it, great, it doesn't mean I'll hate it, you know, it's kind of meaningless, you know, at the end of the day, because it just means that's their opinion, awesome, cool. And hopefully you get to know them, and maybe you get to know what they like and dislike, so then it becomes more of a service. Like, oh, cool, well, I know they like this game, and I agree with them, I love that game too. And then they're reviewing this game that's a similar genre, and they gave it a good score. Chances are I'm going to like it too. So there is value in that. But if it's just you're looking at one review at a time in a vacuum, it's kind of nice to have multiple comments, you know, at least a little kind of summary from each person, and hopefully a little score as well. I think ideally, but you know, that's completely impractical. You know, you can't have, especially these days when you have most video game news websites are done for the love of it. You know, they're not necessarily getting paid much or anything. It's just a bunch of people doing it, and they have their full-time job and they're doing it for the love of it. So you can't expect them to, you know, do all these crazy things that you would love to have, because it's just not practical. And even the websites that could afford to do it don't do it because they can't afford to do it either.
No, like not
because there's not much. Yeah, it's not much money in it. You know, it's a tough business to be profitable in. So you just have to kind of go where the money is, go where the clicks are. And it's a tough one, man. Yeah. Anyway,
I don't get many, yeah. But I still, you know, I still enjoy.
Yeah, it's fun, doing right?
It, so.
Yeah, definitely.
I try to run through these a little faster. Harmonic Music VR. I only really tried the art mode in that game. I actually let one of the girls. Even though on the box for PSVR it says not for kids 12 and under. I let her just try the art thing for like 3 or 4 minutes because she was like begging me like, "Let me try." So I let her, you know, draw a little bit.
Yeah.
It's not a whole lot of movement there. I figured she'd be okay. She enjoyed it. It was fun.
Yeah, no, that does look neat. Yeah, yeah.
And, you know, to be able to draw something and kind of stand in it is pretty cool.
Yeah.
So yeah, she definitely was liking that. 100-foot robot golf. I tried that before I got the PlayStation VR. I tried that on the PS4. That's some No Goblin, Dan Teasdale. I don't know if you ever played Roundabout.
No.
It's kind of like Kuru Kuru Kurin, like the game where you have to like rotate the stick, but you do it with like the limo. But anyway, Roundabout is fantastic. But it has that same sense of humor. So he has the McElroy's doing all types of commentary. It's a goofy golf game. Because you're a giant 100-foot robot, you can smash obstacles in your way. You can shoot lasers at buildings and stuff. In terms of the VR, it kind of made me a little sick.
Oh, come on.
Because it's a weird perspective it has you playing from.
Right.
You're not the robot.
Okay.
But you're still, it's like, even when the game starts, it's like, you're almost like someone standing next to the robot. That's what you feel like, because you're not the robot.
And it's just a bit off-putting, yeah?
Yeah, a little bit. Now, it may be something I can tweak in the menus, but I feel like the game is fun and funny. Without the VR, you don't have to have the VR to make the game fun to play. So that one didn't really work out so well. Hatsune Miku First Stage, that's not really a Hatsune Miku game in the classic sense. It's more like a performance where you can adjust how you see her singing.
Interesting.
The view, at one point it did do the little thing where, like, the actual rhythm game, it pop something like that up for like 2 seconds, but then it went away, and I was like, well, wait a minute, how did I make that happen? But it's not really supposed to give you that full game experience. It's more like, hey, she's doing a concert of these three songs, you can pick them in any order and kind of like shake the move controller like you're shaking one of the glow sticks in the crowd. So it's a little more, it's active, but it's really passive. It's really a passive experience. At least it was for me. But I've heard there's a lot of secrets and different things you can do that you might not be aware of if you keep playing it. So,
I'll very cool. No, I need a. It is amazing, though. Just putting the heads on, it's just amazing. It's just, I don't know. It's just, obviously it's immersive, naturally, but it is. It's quite amazing when the frame rate and everything's set up right and you put that on, you really... It does trick you. It really does trick you to think you're there. And like you said, especially with the 3D sound as well. And yeah, pretty amazing. Amazing stuff. There's that is it Silent Hill or is it Resident Evil game for it where you're sitting in a chair?
Oh, the kitchen demo. I didn't try that yet. That I don't want to do the scary stuff. I don't know if I'm ready for that.
Because I imagine that'd be really effective. I mean, based on my limited experience with it, anything even partially scary would be freaking terrifying.
Because you feel like, like you're there, and I don't know if I want to feel
really
that way.
Real. Yeah, I would think that would be terrible. You'd be really careful with that. You could really upset someone with that stuff. Because I was just standing there, and a freaking whale was swimming by, and I was like, oh gosh. And that wasn't even trying to be scary, but it kind of unnerves you a little bit. So I think if you're in a room and some gross stuff is happening, oof. That would be terrifying.
Yeah,
pretty cool though. I mean,
I'll check it out. Yeah. There is a demo for it. There's no reason why. It's funny. I downloaded the because it came with demos on a disc, but I just downloaded it like a couple days prior. And cool. The thing is, I booted it up and then never got a chance to go back to it because I got some stuff in for reviews. So I was playing that.
Oh yeah, right.
I got put up a review for Waddle Home, which is sort of a Lemmings inspired game where you have to guide these penguins to pick up the eggs and go to the exit.
Right.
The issues I have with it is
that's in VR?
Yeah, it is. I don't think the VR really adds anything. It's a fun game. You like the old Lemmings kind of stuff.
It's just a good game. That's good.
Yeah, and there's no fail states. Like with Lemmings, if too many of them fell off the cliff or blew up, you lost.
Yeah.
With this, the only real hazard is you can get captured by security bots and they lock you up, but you can come right back out. So I like that. So they didn't give you any kind of annoying to restart this level. It does get difficult.
Yeah.
The issue I have is the distance that it would show the level. Sometimes the level was like right under my nose. Other times it was like 5 feet away. I'm like, well, how do I set?
How do I get over there?
Yeah.
No, you have to physically move in your room to get there,
Did I have to do what?
You have to physically walk over there in your room to get there?
No, well, I think I kept pressing. I think if you hold down the options button, it sort of adjusts it. I think I kept pressing that. And it wasn't like a one-to-one, like, okay, this is making it closer. I just kept messing around with it until it finally got to a place where I felt comfortable.
Interesting.
But
yeah, pretty awesome. I'm excited about VR. I think it's been very interesting to see where that goes. You know, it'd be fun to see what experiences come from that. It's really neat that Sony's doing that.
And here's another interesting thing. There's a game called The Assembly. I don't know if this is... I'm assuming this is already out probably on the PC for the Vive and Oculus. It's a story-driven game where you're some kind of a scientist who gets swept away to be a part of some secret program. But there's two narratives. There's that narrative and then a narrative of somebody who's at the facility that person got taken away from. I'm assuming the story was at some point have these two people come face-to-face. And it's interesting. But I kept wondering why, and you know, like any first person, third person game, you move the right analog stick, you turn, you know,
right?
You turn, you look at in Dementium, you turn, you look and move, you turn, you look,
right.
But in VR, the default setting for a lot of things are to have you just kind of skip there. You just kind of bamf, for lack of a better word.
Oh, you click where you want to go and you just go kind of thing.
Yeah, and I kept wondering, I kept thinking, okay, that's one way of doing it. And I went into the menus in the game, the game called The Assembly, and you can turn that off and to put it on normal. So I said, oh, normal. Jules,
interesting.
I made it about 10 seconds.
Right.
Because normal meant, if I just move the right analog stick, it would just turn in that direction. But it was so off-putting. My eyes were screaming. So I went right back to the skipping. I'm thinking, this is why they did it. Because either it can't keep the frame rate high enough doing that, or it's just, if you want to vomit, that's like Epicac. That's the perfect way to vomit. If you want to.
There's definitely some huge limitations to VR in that regard, for sure. I remember I was checking out a demo that someone had at some developer, and it was just, they had some amazing just environments, so you could just walk around it in VR. And I was like, yeah, cool. So I was standing, at their desk kind of thing with the headset on and just using the analog, 360 controller, just using it just to kind of move around, in VR. And it's really quick. Start to feel like, oh, this is weird. Because my head thinks I'm moving, but I'm not. And that was, it's like, you know, it's car sickness, essentially.
Yep.
I mean, and I don't even get that. But I was starting to feel it. And I was like, wow. Yeah, and I have a pretty high tolerance for that. And it, but I was starting to really feel it. Like some people, immediately, they're gone. It's like, no, they have to take it off. Yeah, so that there's a lot of limitation there. You can't just do a straight up FPS in that thing.
No.
I don't
think it would work. And I wonder how something like, what is it, Rigs, that like kind of esports mech game? I don't know how that would work because...
Well, there's that Serious Sam game. I don't know what platform it's on, probably just Steam, I guess. But I think that's just a full up FPS, like virtual reality. And that's like, huh, how does that work? Because, yeah, my experience is that's not easy to play. You feel sick really fast. Yeah. Hmm. I don't know. But a lot of it is the frame rate, though, as well. That helps a lot. If you've got one-to-one movement, that helps a lot. If it's laggy at all, ugh.
Yeah, because, I mean, one of the reasons for the breakout box, like, obviously, is for more power. Because they have to keep it, what, at 120 frame, whatever there's a requirement for frames.
I think it is 120 or whatever, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, so. Super. Yeah, a friend of mine, actually, Brian Watson, was one of the engineers on the PlayStation VR, like the hardware.
Nice.
Yeah, and he was talking about, yeah, they were, he was really proud. He doesn't work here now, but he was there when they were developing it, one of the lead engineers. And yeah, they managed to get it screaming pretty fast. So they got rid of a lot of the issues that if you don't have that frame rate, then it's like, ugh. Yeah, so it's, yeah, I remember him telling me it's just a little bit of the story of that. It's pretty neat.
And I think the last thing for VR I'll mention is, I don't know if you heard of the game Bound, made by Plastic Studios, and also I think Sony Santa Monica has some involvement in it as well.
Right.
It's I reviewed the game. It came out maybe a month or two ago. Some people call it a platformer. It's more like a narrative driven. Emotional journey game, but it is a platformer, you know.
Okay.
You do jump on platform, but it's not like a Mario platform. It's a character. I don't want to spoil everything, but she is a character in this like magical world where her dancing kind of deflects the issues around her and lets her deal with hardships.
Cool.
That game in VR is beautiful. I mean, it is. They sent me, you know, the press kit saying, hey, when the PSVR comes out, we'll enable the VR mode. I'm like, okay. And that's why I was tweeting about it. And I said, like, no one's talking about this, but that is one of the most impressive things I've seen. It is a beautiful game regardless, but the fact that you could be, standing in it.
Right.
It's just amazing. And you're not looking through her eyes. You can move the camera around.
You can see everything.
Yeah, that's awesome, it's really... It's breathtaking, and it's one of those things where people were questioning, will we be able to do real full games? It's like, it's not an action packed game. There's not really enemies. Yeah. There's no combat.
It's just a great experience.
Yeah, and it really,
it's
different because,
like
I said, with the whole skipping thing, like you're just kind of telling the camera where to go as opposed to like moving it on the way.
Yeah.
So you're taking it from being somewhat analog to more like just a digital, okay, go over here, go over there.
Yeah.
But it's, I'm digging it.
And I think that speaks to just the strength of VR, you know, it's just, it's the experience, you know, it's not going to replace or even emulate video games, you know, there's obviously some place where they overlap, but it's so different, you know, it's not comparable really to a flat screen video game experience. It's just not. It's just so different. And even simple things like Skype, you know, or video conferencing through VR is awesome. I mean, you can just imagine how cool would that be. Or even watching Netflix. You know, I think there is a Netflix VR thing where you can choose to be sitting on the beach somewhere. And then, you know, and the TV is kind of wedged into the sand on the beach. You're literally sitting on the beach somewhere with a TV wedged in the sand in VR. So you're watching TV in a virtual living room.
Aren't you losing part of the real estate for the movie, though? For the sake of the beach?
Well, yeah. But, I mean, it's just a virtual living room. You know, it's just like...
Yeah, that's true.
If your apartment is a total dump... or whatever, or you just want to escape somewhere, you know, you're like, great, you know, I want to have a big flat screen TV and watch my regular TV show in this environment. You know, it's just silly, but, and it's, you know, it's just fun, you know, it's just different. Or like I say, or video conferencing, or just social aspects, you know, or just, you know, just lots of things, lots of communication experience, you know, applications I think could be used in there, which is really interesting. I think it's really fun to see where that goes. Yeah, just silly fun things like Minority Report, just that whole interactive, you know, virtual display in front of you, just lots of little things like that. I think as that progresses, it'll be really fun. If it takes off and becomes a little bit more of a way of life, part of our lifestyle, it'll be fun to kind of see where that goes, if it goes anywhere.
I look forward to a day where I can play Mutant Muds. And I'm right there, you know.
Right, you are the water hitting the mud.
I can like walk in between like the foreground and the background.
Right.
You should write that down. No, okay.
Yeah, that would be fun. That would be interesting. But no, it's good fun to see where it goes, man. But yeah, it's great to see Sony make such a massive investment in that and pull it off pretty damn well.
I have to say, they did. I mean, like I said, there are some things that just experiences that really won't be for me. But overall, I'm very pleased with it.
Yeah, that's awesome. And how much is it? I don't know what the retail price is of that thing now.
Okay, just
they're 400, 300.
It's 400 without like just the headset and the breakout box.
Okay.
The demo disc.
And see, that's not terrible. Box. I mean, it's obviously a lot of money, but that's not terrible for a first revision price for that hardware. That's not terrible.
No, and it's $5 to get two Move controllers. I don't know if you got controllers and then the PlayStation VR experience, which like a full, I guess, retail thing. Oh, it's $40.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
But yeah. But if you have the camera already and Move, speaking of Move controllers, I have four. I found out one just won't charge at all. It won't hold a charge for anything. So I actually opened it up, snatched the battery out, and then went to eBay and ordered some new ones. For a reasonable price.
Boom. Fixed.
I think they were like $7.
Speaking of which, we nearly made a Dementium game for Move. Because Move came out on the PS3. Is that right?
Yes. Yep.
Yeah. We nearly made a PS3 version of Dementium.
Really?
Using the Move as a launch Move game. We were actually pitching that to South Peak. And they were actually really on board with it. This very nearly happened. We nearly made a Dementium game for the Move PS3.
What happened?
It was called something else at the time, the Move, wasn't it? What was it originally called? It's called something else. I don't know. I don't know. They just didn't move forward with it for some reason. We wanted to do it. We were very happy about it. I don't know. They just didn't pull the trigger on it.
And it would have been scary, too. That would have been interesting.
Yeah, that would have been. Yeah, we were really excited about that.
I don't think they had anything. Did they have anything that was scary for the Move?
I don't know. I'm not really.
You could play, I think, BioShock Infinite or something with the Move, but okay. I don't think that's really scary.
But yeah, no, we were really excited about that. It's going to be fun.
I learned a lot today.
But yeah, that was fun, man. Yeah, we had a whole pitch for this, I guess, next gen, you know, Dementium game. But yeah, they just weren't willing to. I mean, well, they were on the way out, let's face it. They were going down. So that's probably where they're like, well, where do you put
South Peak, yeah.
Yeah. So this was kind of the end of, or towards the end of them, I suppose. So that's obviously why they didn't want to do it, I guess, in the end. But they were very gung-ho for it. You know, we got early versions of the Wand, or what was it called? Was it the Move or the Wand? Was it
the Move controller and the Nav controller is the only thing.
Whatever the hell that was called. But yeah, we got early versions of that. We got to check it out. We pitched it to Sony. They were really excited about it. So we were making some good progress on it.
So you would use the Move controller as like the flashlight.
Exactly.
And then you would, like, once you hit the, I guess, the T button or whatever, would it switch to the gun or you have to hit another
button? I have no idea. We didn't get that far. I don't know. It was just concept. I don't know. I mean, it was just concept. But yeah, it would have totally been the flashlight. That would have been a primary use for it, yes. And then whatever else from beyond that. I don't know. Yeah, we didn't ever get into it and actually demo it, unfortunately.
So I guess for those who don't know, what I know, Dementium is now being released like it's like HD versions. So what is the story with that now?
Well, we did a remastered version of Dementium, the first Dementium on 3DS.
Mm-hmm.
Came out, was that end of last year? When did that come out? I don't even know. Fairly recently. And that, I think, looks fantastic. Greg did a really good job, like adding the specular highlights of the chest more, and a lot of the enemies look really wet and gross and sticky. Really, they look really good when the lighting hits them and stuff.
He knows his 3D.
Yeah, he really does. So yeah, I love it. I think Dominitium, it runs at 60 frames a second. I mean, it's a really good version of the game. I mean, it's really, it's a big improvement over the original DS release. Yeah, it's great. And yeah, so that came out on the eShop download. And whether Dominitium 2 remastered sees the light of day or not on 3DS, I don't know. I mean, that's in Greg's hands now, so I don't know if that's going to happen. We started development of that a while ago, but then we had to put it on hold to work on other things, and then we decided to end things anyway, so I don't know if they're going to pick that up again and finish it or not. I have no idea. So that's it for now. But, you know, he has the IPs, and hopefully he'll do something with them in the future in some form.
Were you excited to hear about, I guess, a sequel to Red Dead Redemption coming out next year?
Definitely. That game is great. Yeah, definitely. I know, it's like, new game coming out a year from now. I was like, wow, okay. But I mean, obviously, they're probably actually pretty far along, actually. A year isn't that long, actually, for a game of that magnitude. But,
no, it's not.
And I don't know if they've released any information on it, but, I mean, just the teaser that they released suggests that it's multiple people. Maybe it's a posse. Maybe it's multiplayer. Maybe it's, you know, MMO-esque. I don't know. Whatever. We'll see, I guess.
I guess a GTA Online, but more in the world of...
Yeah, I would imagine you can be a band of people going around causing havoc. That'd be quite fun.
Maybe an actual band.
Yes, indeed. If you want to be, why not? What a great game. Holy crap. I mean, that was a great game.
You know, I've never really played, but I've put about 2 hours in, and open world games just kind of lose me after a while.
Yeah, you really have to have like a rainy weekend kind of situation to get into a game like that for me. Yeah, you really have to have a lot of freaking time where you have nothing else that you can do.
I appreciate
I played that quite a bit, and wow, really, what an impressive game.
I rebought it too, because it's really well compatible, so I bought it again. Mm. And then
Xbox One.
Yeah.
What a good game. Yeah, really, really enjoyed that game. So that'd be fun to see what they do. Yeah, really good stuff. I like the Red Dead Revolver. It's pretty good, too.
I never played that one. That was the one on PS2 as well.
Is it? Yeah. That's pretty good. I mean, not even close to being as good as Red Dead Revolver. Red Dead Redemption. But, yeah, it was good, though. But, so that's exciting. Very fun.
The other little piece of news is United Front Games closed down. Kind of suddenly.
What did they do?
Sleeping Dogs.
Oh, right.
Something else they did too. Though that game Smash and Grab, I think just came out, maybe early access on Steam. It's just gone.
So they were doing big games, like big budget kind of games, I guess. I don't know about Smash and Grab, but the other one was pretty big, right? Sleeping Dogs.
Yes, well, that was pretty big.
I think of something else. What is that game? Is that third person? Maybe I'm thinking of something.
It's an open world game.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So yeah,
it's
very
a shame,
risky.
Though. They just kind of
who published that.
Smash and Grab or Sleeping Dogs?
Sleeping Dogs.
I think it was Square Enix.
Oh, man.
Yeah,
interesting.
It's them.
I'm not surprised, man. It's a tough time right now.
I guess it just came out of nowhere. Like, it just, oh, we're gone.
Yeah, that sucks. Well, on to more fun, good news. What's happening tomorrow?
Yeah, the NX. Are they announcing a teaser trailer? Or the?
So far it's, what they've revealed is a 3-minute preview trailer. It's what they'll have on Nintendo.com tomorrow at, 7 Pacific, 10 Eastern.
I'll be there.
Yeah, man, me too. Perfect timing.
We'll all be there, so it doesn't,
That's going to be awesome. So that's going to be very fun. Very fun to see what on earth that little video has in it. And then what that means after that, you know? I don't know. I'm very interested to see how tomorrow morning goes. That's going to be cool, man.
I'm going to be doing it tomorrow, not Friday, because Friday would be like a conflict. But yeah, tomorrow I should be good to check out.
I know, for Friday, I need to be watching season 3 of Black Mirror. That's what I'll be doing.
I've never seen that show, or know almost any. What is that show about?
It's pretty twisted, man. It's fascinating. If you like kind of sci-fi, thriller, not horror per se, but it's definitely more grown up. Definitely some twisted concepts in some of them. Some are just really fascinating. Some are just like, whoa, that's so weird. It's just kind of a weird, almost like a sci-fi modern Twilight Zone, but different, you know? Very cool.
Did you like...
Very cool.
I like Stranger Things. If I like that, you think I would like Black Mirror?
Yeah. I mean, it's a little bit trippier than that. I mean, Stranger Things is more grounded because it has a lot more normal stuff going on, you know? With normal people and normal families with strange crap happening. This is sometimes just an alternate reality or super futuristic kind of setting. Quite fun. Or, if I remember rightly, I think episode 1 or 2, I think it is anyway, it's actually just present day, but a very strange political situation. So it's quite varied. They go all over the place. But I just recently actually watched season 2. I didn't even realize it was out, and I was like, oh my gosh, actually no, the last 2 episodes, sorry, of season 2, I hadn't even watched, but I just watched those just recently, and they're really fun, very strange, really fun. So yeah, I'm very much looking forward to season 3. Very well done. Definitely recommend it.
If I can check out season 1.
Yeah, they're all on Netflix, so they're all up.
Oh,
there.
Okay. Yeah. Oh, so it is a Netflix, right? It is a Netflix show.
Yeah. Actually, while we're on TV shows, I've been watching Veep on Amazon Prime. You know, Veep with Julie
of Louis Dreyfus. Yeah, I saw a bunch of the first season, really enjoyed it, just kind of fell off.
Oh my gosh, so funny. I'm giggling, like embarrassingly giggling when I'm watching that freaking show, man. So funny. Because I love it because she just sells it so well. Like, she's the Veep. But she's swearing like a sailor, and just the way she delivers those lines freaking cracks me up, man. I mean, just they're so crass and so rude, so freaking funny. Like, oh, I love it.
And just how she has to lie and make everybody feel good about everything.
It's so awkward, because it has definitely moments of The Office, you know, those awkward moments. And you're like cringing, and it's just so funny. Oh my god.
I love it. I really like it. I think that might be one of my favorite TV shows. I mean, both. I love the UK version.
Yeah,
but I mean, I've watched both of those series multiple times.
Yeah, they're both great. Yeah, it's so good. Yeah. But yeah, I'm on season 2 of Veep now, and I love it. It's so funny. I like political stuff like that. I just find it so interesting to see the behind the scenes and how that potentially could work. Just the system is so ridiculous. It's so convoluted and absurd. Just so fun to see. Like, do you ever watch House of Cards?
The first season or two, which I enjoyed. I fall off stuff.
Yeah, I love that as well. It's just so interesting. Obviously, Veep is not like that.
Yeah, then she's not killing worlds. People or anything.
No, she's not killing anyone. But anyway, so that's what I'm watching right now. It's mainly Veep. That's my go-to show. God, it's so freaking funny. I think there are 4 seasons out, I think. And the first 2 or 3 if you're a Prime member on Amazon.
Oh, okay.
And the other 2 if you have to pay for. So I'm like, oh gosh, I can already tell I'm going to have to buy those other 2 seasons, aren't I? Yep, I am. Good stuff, man. Speaking of which, I really liked Hannibal. I watched that on Amazon Prime as well.
That ended, though. People were kind of upset, I remember.
Yeah, I haven't watched the last season yet. I watched the first 2 or 3 or whatever it was, but I haven't watched the last one. If that's 4, I'm not sure what the last season is, but I haven't watched it, whatever it is. It's good though. Have you watched any of it?
No, I've seen the movies, but I never saw any of the shows.
It's pretty gruesome, actually. They do not hold back. Yeah, it's a weird it's gruesome, but they do it in a very artistic way. Very strange, because yeah, I don't want to spoil anything, but yeah, it's wow. It's quite a mixture of emotions they're throwing at you with the crazy crap they do in that show. Really well done, though. really well done.
I just finished up Community. You ever watched Community?
No, I haven't. What's that?
That's what I was explaining it to the folks for the show last week. It was an NBC comedy about a guy. He's a lawyer, and then somehow the firm finds out that he doesn't really have a bachelor's degree. He has to go to community college, try to take some of these courses in order to get his bachelor's again. And comedy ensues.
Old guy, basically, at college kind of thing.
Well, he's not old because it's Joel McHale. So he's like mid to late 30s. Chevy Chase was, his character was the curmudgeonly old guy. He forms a study group with a diverse group of people. And the show isn't grounded in reality. Like, they do episodes where there's zombies, where there's cartoons. I mean, it really goes.
Oh, it's very creative.
Very much so. You'd like I think you'd like it. It's on Hulu.
Okay, that's the one I don't have yet. Okay.
All six seasons are on Hulu. Because the last season, Yahoo.
The six seasons? Wow.
Yeah, but five and six are like half a season.
Okay.
Yeah. But yeah, check it out. It's pretty good.
Okay. Yeah, I like Jim Carroll. It's fun. Is that who said Joe McHale, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Actually, that reminds me, Silicon Valley is freaking hilarious.
Yeah, Tiny loves that show.
Oh my gosh. Have you seen it? Do you like
I've just seen clips, and I know I would like it. How can I start from the beginning and watch it?
So good.
Is it on Netflix?
It's on HBO.
Oh, HBO. Yeah, I cut the cord. So
HBO Go, you get it on that, and if you want to buy it piecemeal, I think, or that monthly thing, probably. I think it's HBO.
Yeah, it's like $15 or something like that for the app.
Yeah, but yeah, because we have HBO, and yeah, wow, that's really funny too. And the characters are amazing. They're such good. They're all so different. They're all so good. Like, all of them, man, they're freaking great. So good. Because there's the main, But yeah, really good stuff. Good cast, good characters. Really funny, completely ridiculous. So good. I need to get back to that. Yeah. Yeah, actually, I'm not caught up on that. I need to go back to that. So good. I love TV now, man. It's crazy the great shows that they're making these days. It's amazing.
That's why people ask me how I play some of the games. I'm like, that's because I gave up a lot of TV.
I do it, yeah. True. Yeah, I don't watch half as much TV as I used to. But it's so convenient. You can just watch it when you want to, you know?
Yeah. Which is really nice. That's something easy to cut the cord because it's like, I just stream everything anyway, so.
Yeah, I guess Game of Thrones and Walking Dead will be coming up soon, so I'll have to watch those, unfortunately. Yeah, because they're starting... When is Walking Dead starting again? It's like this weekend or next weekend?
I gave up after season three. Not because I didn't like it, just because I always tap out.
Yeah. I think it's next weekend. I'm not sure. But I'm not sure when Game of Thrones starts up. Probably next month. I'm not sure. Anyway, whatever. Good stuff.
I guess to bring all of this sort of to a close, if you want to plugs and all that kind of stuff, shout outs, even if you just want to run through a list of everything people can, people can buy at the various stores, whatever.
Totally, man. I mean, all of the Atui stuff now is all on the 3DS eShop. Obviously, there's Mutant Muds, there's Bomb Monkey, there's Zeo Drifter. And there's Mutant Mod Super Challenge. Mm-hmm. And of course, I mean, Dementium Remastered and Moon Chronicles, which I was involved with, as well as ATB Wild Ride. I feel like I'm forgetting something, actually, but whatever. but that's all up there. But no, I'm working on Chicken Wiggle right now, which is a really fun project. It's just a fun puzzle platform game with really robust, awesome little editor built into it. So it's the amount of the ingredients that we managed to put in there is pretty, pretty cool, actually. And you can all use them in any combination you want. So I think the creativity, it's going to be really fun to see what people end up doing with the levels. And you're able to share them online. And even if you don't want to make them, you know, you'll be able to kind of just get the game, jump online through the game, and just look at the levels that are up there and just download them and play them. You know, so even if you don't want to make them, you can just play all these crazy levels and horribly difficult levels, I'm sure, that people are playing and uploading up there. So that's really fun. So we're wrapping that up now, hoping that will come out early next year, 3DS. And after that, pretty soon actually, I hope to move, because it takes a long time once the game's even, once Chicken Wiggle's even finished, it'll just take a long time to kind of get it through the Nintendo approval process, and then even if it's approved before the end of this year, we won't be releasing it until January anyway, because we don't want to directly compete with Super Mario Maker on the 3DS that's coming out in December.
Yeah, but it sounds like Chicken Wiggle is more feature rich.
Well, at least it's online sharing for
once. Exactly.
Huge, bizarre thing that they're not doing that. I really
I'm hoping that
comprehend.
They're gonna like
at that, yeah, it seems like a huge faux pas. That makes no sense.
Remove
in any
the ability to run. What? Like what?
It's like okay. Anyway, so yeah, we're gonna have that out early next year, and then this year I'll be moving back onto Treasure Noughts to finish that up for next year. So that's super exciting. So yeah, man, no, very cool. All gung ho, all moving forward, making some good stuff. And we have plans for games beyond Treasure Noughts as well. So, yeah, very excited.
Sort of a Dementium Mutant Muds crossover.
Right. Probably not. No, unfortunately. But, actually, we will have some news regarding Muds on Sony platforms soon. I mean, they're already on there, of course, as you probably know, but Muds and Super Challenge are already on there. But we actually have some news regarding that coming up pretty soon as well.
Okay.
So that'll be coming out. Gosh, I'm not even sure. Next few weeks, anyway, we'll have some news to share on we're partnering up. You know, we're partnering up with Nighthawk to we published Super Challenge with them on PS4 and Vita and Steam, and we're also working with them to do Treasure Noughts. Anyway, so we're working with them. We have some special fun news to share in the coming weeks. In regards to Muds and the Sony family. So anyway, so that'd be fun. So that's cool. A couple of things, actually. So that's exciting. So yeah, lots of stuff going, man. We're staying busy. We're staying busy. So I'm excited. It's good stuff. And thank you for having me on your show, man. I appreciate that, dude.
Oh, thank you for coming back. You are always welcome here.
Thank you, sir. And my website, of course, if we're doing the plugs, I think we're doing the plugs now.
Yeah.
is atui.com. So atoi.com. Simple as that, atui.com. I need to add it on there, but I actually have a newsletter that everyone can sign up for as well, that I tweeted out on my Twitter account, which is Jules Watchum. And that's actually pretty fun. I'm going to do something a little bit different that I haven't done before or didn't do with Renegade Kid. I want to use the newsletter as something that people actually... I don't know, something a little bit different, something I actually look forward to. So I'm going to use that to release unique screenshots and information and competitions that is only released through the newsletter. And obviously once it's been released, everyone, if someone in the press wants to release it, of course that's great. Everyone's welcome to do that. But I'll kind of want to use the newsletter as a resource for people to sign up for, to actually get that information immediately directly from me in that way, because I think that'd be kind of fun. So anyway, so I have plans for that. So that'll be fun. So I'm going to try and do the newsletter a little bit better than we did in the past. So that's exciting. So yes, fun stuff is ahead.
Sounds good. You know, the one thing I didn't ask you about was, now that it's been out for a while, what are your thoughts on the new 3DS nub?
It's not great.
Okay. I was just curious. After some time, it's okay. I felt the same way. I kind of felt like, why didn't just put an actual analog on it?
Yeah. It's not great. That's my thoughts on it. It's not great. Yeah. I mean, I don't like dual stick first person controls anyway. I'm not a huge fan of that. I prefer either a mouse or the stylus, actually, on the 3DS or DS. But like with Moon and the Dementium, and it works fine with a nub on there. But I always prefer the stylus to aim and look. overusing that thing.
It's faster.
It's faster. It's more fidelity, and the knob is a very limited range. It's so tiny. It's just it's not great. Yeah, that was kind of a Band-Aid. Not very good one either. The Band-Aid fell off in the shower. It wasn't very good.
Clogged the drain.
It did. It clogged the drain. It was like, oh dear. Yeah. It wasn't dressed properly. It didn't work out.
I don't know, it's a weird question to ask at the end. It's just,
it's interesting. I'd written I'd never down, been asked like, that.
Make sure you ask him about the dog.
No, that's cool, man. No, I mean, I haven't really thought about it, but when you ask it, I'm like, well, honestly, yeah. Not that great. I like everything else about the new 3DS, and I really like the regular circle pad. I love the buttons. The start button is a bit odd. I think oddly positioned. That would be my only gripe with the new 3DS.
You think the start should be on the bottom? Or maybe to the right.
Where is it? Well, it's on the front. So on the new 3DS, the smaller one, it's on the very front. So it's on the outside. So when it's closed, it's on the outside. It's on the front bottom. So
Or the start? Which one?
The power.
Oh, it's same with the big one. Yeah, it's okay. A little weird.
That's a little odd to me. It's just very small gripe. It's not a big deal. It just seems to, like, I don't know. It just seems odd. It just seems like it should be on the inside, but whatever. But no, I really like this machine a lot. I'm really fond of it. It's very, very nice. And I have the faceplate that actually is felt. So actually, texture-wise, feels fantastic. It actually is fuzzy. So I have a fuzzy 3DS, which is really awesome. It goes really well with the matte finish for the rest of it. It's pretty awesome, man. I like it a lot.
I can tell. I just have a hard plastic Legend of Zelda
thing. A cold, hard plastic shell.
Exactly.
Right.
It's cynical, too. It's cold, hard, cynical plastic.
Right. You get some really cool covers for it, actually. I did get one for my new XL. It's a Mario one. It's kind of kind of rubber kind of texture that wraps around it. And it actually works quite well. Better than I thought it would. It was really affordable. I just got it on Amazon. And it's a Mario themed one, and it's great. I like it a lot, actually. It makes it look really cool, and it's soft, and yeah, it's nice. You're looking for such a thing.
Now you gotta admit, you start looking for 3DS, new 3DS covers.
Right.
Or NX carrying cases. Who knows?
Yes, exactly. Accessorize. Fun stuff. Yeah, and I really got into that with my Vita. That was the orange Vita, man.
God, yeah, I saw you so tweeting cool. about it. You were hyped.
Oh, man, I really am. It's a really beautiful machine.
It is it's a unique color. It's one that I've never seen.
It's so cool. And I've got a really cool kind of cobalt blue case for it. And yeah, it's pretty awesome, man. Really nice combo. So yeah, I was really attached to that for a while. So I actually haven't touched my 3DS for a little while. I was playing... Well, actually, I did play the cool case, I guess, on there. But before that, I was playing Castlevania, the SNES Castlevania, which is great. Oh, so good.
You should you should pick up Pacross 3D Round 2.
So which
one? Pacross 3D Round 2.
Oh, I do have that. No, it was good. I got it. Yeah, it was pretty decent. Really overpriced. That's $30 as well. Speaking of overpriced puzzle games.
Yeah, but... I didn't get it day one because I was kind of hesitant, like $30. But yeah. I know, but you can really spend some time with that thing. So ultimately,
it's a really solid game, really well done, very high production, really well done. Hopefully, I'll see you at PAX East next year. Are you gonna go?
Are
you close to there, or how? I mean, is that quite a travel for you, or how far away are you?
I'm in Maryland, right outside DC. So
okay.
I just hop on a Southwest flight and I'm there. But it's funny, my wife is from Boston. The thing is, her birthday is that Saturday.
Oh, wow. So yeah, it's not
happening. It's probably not happening.
Unless she wants her birthday in Boston. So, right.
We have our three kids with us, too. But yeah.
Right. I didn't realize you were in D.C. Okay.
Yeah.
Oh, I just assumed that you were close to Boston because I saw you there a couple of times. That's so weird. Okay. No, so you, yeah, wow, you traveled in. Okay. Cool.
I mean, you know, jump on a Southwest flight. You know, it's not a big deal. I mean, I've driven there, not for PAX, but I mean, you know, I got some nice families there from there. So,
yeah,
we're there. Not.
Did you go to PAX West?
Because you're obviously... I've never been out there.
Okay.
Because great. Every time PAX West is always around the time my kids go back to school.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
So it's never a good time. South, I haven't even. South is always around the time of MAGFest. You ever heard of MAGFest?
It's in January, right?
Yep. Right after.
I've never been to PAX South, actually. I should. It's an hour away. It's just down there, but I've never been there yet. I should probably go.
You probably should go if you're an hour away. But I know booths aren't free, so.
No, I'm not going to do a booth. But yeah, no, I should go down there and check it out at least.
Yeah. Yeah. An hour away. Yeah. Well, you know, I love indies, man. I could spend days just.
Yeah. Super fun.
Checking stuff out.
Yeah.
They make fun of me every year.
Yeah, man.
How many points?
Well, let me know. 90. Let me know when you're going to go to another one anyway. And, because, I'm never sure which one I go to. I went to PAX West this year. That was super fun. I haven't been to that one for a while. So that was great. That's a great experience. So, it's fun, man. I might even try and do GDC next year. I don't know. That's in, let's say, usually a week, or actually either at the same time or the week before PAX East. So we'll see. Anyway, cool, man. Well, I guess I should let you go.
Yeah, thank you for coming on the show again. If anybody, I'll have all Jules' information in the show notes. And if you want to email us, podcast@gameofthrones.com, voicemails 202-573-7686. Thank you for your time. I appreciate it.
Thank you, sir.
Have a good night.